Jarvis, drop my needle.
Hello, this is the hardcore legend Mick Foley, and if you are interested in listening to idiots, you came to the right place. Have a nice day.
Woo! That's an attention getter.
He's a very strange young man.
He's an idiot.
What we're dealing with here is a complete lack of respect for the law.
Oh my God, he's an idiot.
You know, of course, that you're out of your jurisdiction.
Personally, I think you're an idiot.
But that's the evidence in the car!
But I was going into Toshi Station to pick up some power converters.
Always like to keep my audience riveted.
Greetings, ladies and gentlemen, friends and fiends, and welcome to Free Range Idiocy, the podcast about everything, but mostly just the stuff we like. To paraphrase Mark Anthony, and here we speak of the Roman general rather than the Van Halen bassist, of course, we have not come here to praise Tom Brady, but to bury him. Ah, who are we kidding? After 22 NFL seasons and more Super Bowls than we ever thought the New England Patriots had a right to win in the first place, we're definitely here to throw some more praise onto the already mammoth pile that's been accumulating over the last few days. That's right, this is not a drill, it's not speculation, and it's not one of those 10,000 premature, he's finally falling off reports that we used to go through over the past, like, 18 years. Tom Brady is officially calling it quits, and we're going to break it down in this episode 92, Bradygeddon, the Finalest chapter. I am your Uncle Todd, and with me, as always, is the man who is legendary in Sega Genesis circles for his prowess with Madden 96, as well as his inability to realize that Barry Foster was going to run him down every single time. He has been my partner in idiocy for over two decades and a member of the Clean Plate Club. I give you the man they call Tim.
Greetings and salutations, my friend. How are you?
Doing all right. I've got another coffee here, so everyone better buckle up. I have no idea. I am not responsible for anything that happens in this episode, okay?
Oh, boy. I got to tell you, the caffeinated edition brought the energy, my friend. Energy.
Yeah, either that or I'm just going to pass out midway through. Like, it's going to, I'm just going to be going along, as I'm just, from this end. There's only two ways it's going to go, folks. That's the way it is.
Well, thank you for reminding me. I got to re-up my membership in the Clean Plate Club for this year. So I'll take care of that after this episode.
Oh, I thought you had a lifetime membership with that.
It's touch and go. So
we were talking about our respective weights before in the pre-production meeting, and neither one of us is happy right now. Both of us have been eating like horses and realized very quickly that we are not Clydesdales, although we're starting to resemble them. In weight, we have not hit the point where we need to go to like one of those truck scales yet, but we're heading there. Thankfully, heading there real quick. Unless we take a detour.
Yeah, that's
right. You have a much better chance of that than I do. Although actually I have my first appointment with my trainer in quite a while tomorrow. So I'm sure she's going to take pleasure in whipping me into shape and
there you go.
Making me do exercises that make me go, beg your pardon. What?
Yes.
You want me to do the what with a what and lift what where? Oh, and I'm paying for this? Really? Oh, what a racket this is.
Sure I can't grab that cookie over there?
Do you remember? Okay, here's a sidetrack. Seen this now. There's a gym around here that had the same thing. You remember there was a gym/fitness club in New Hampshire where we grew up, and they had a bar in the fitness club. You remember that?
Oh, I think I do. Yes.
Yeah. And they had one here and they've changed over to now to a smoothie bar. But it used to be like you go in and work out and then you can sit there and have a beer. I'm like, does anybody see where the disconnect is in this? I mean, at all.
Yes.
I mean, why not just have a to-go cup with a straw, get yourself a pina colada and you're over there doing squats like.
Exactly.
You know, exactly. I mean. Why not?
It's not like,
get the beer helmet with the two cans in the side. Just go all in.
It's not like this is a golf course with a clubhouse, right? You know what I mean? Like, it's
yeah. Actually, you know what? I think that's a great idea.
We need to burn calories, right? So
we need to start this thing. It's going to be called Drunk Gym. That's what it's going to be. You have to come in, and it's like a 3-drink minimum,
and then
a bell rings, and everybody has to do a shot. It'd be like CrossFit, but like just sheer mayhem and injuries.
Yes.
I think there's a market for this.
Not to mention, you know, we could do a partnership with Uber to come pick people up afterwards.
Oh, that's a given. That's a given. That's just going to have to happen. Actually, it'll just be a bus that'll drive people back home with a bar on the bus.
A shuttle.
It's like a party bus. You know what? I'm actually, the more we go into this, Patrick, I need you to do some research. All right. I want you to find out if we can get a party bus and a space big enough for a gym and a liquor license in the next month. What? Oh. No, it's not for your birthday. It's a business idea. Well, yeah, we could have your birthday there if you want. Yeah, we can have cake. I mean, we're going to have booze. Why not have cake? A pistachio
gonna
cake?
Wonders. You're going to do wonders for the weight.
All right, do pistachio cake if you want. I mean, whatever, dude. Are you going to go research that? Are we just going to... No, don't look up the pistachio recipes. Go look at the gym stuff. Anyways, sorry.
So I take it he's not on the prowl with the guitar. There's no threat of the El Kabong anymore?
No, I took the guitar away from him.
Okay, good.
I've turned into like a third grade school teacher. Like I've had to take things away. And if he's good for the rest of the semester, he can get it back. We're in that stage of the internship process now. Oh, I've got a locked closet with things that I've had to take away from Patrick. I mean, the guitar, I had to take away the sequin jumpsuit. There was a stapler that I had to take away. Don't ask. Not to mention the staple pullers.
Oh,
that having someone run around, you know, coming at you with a coming after. So we don't have a stapler or a staple puller here anymore.
All right.
Yeah, it's been interesting.
I'm glad to hear things are a bit safer.
Oh, I don't know about that. I mean, still.
He's there in the office, so still something could happen.
Oh, it's like fire starter, dude. I mean, he can start a fire with like the power of his mind. We have matches or lighter around here, and yet stuff's still smoldering every so often. I don't know how it happens. Don't know how it happens.
Good
Although
Lord.
The one thing that I've learned is there. Someone posted that meme. It was either Twitter or Facebook or something. They're like, hey, anything can be a smoke machine if you operate it wrongly enough.
Oh, jeez.
I really think that's basically Patrick's method of operation for everything.
All right.
I see. I mean, I'll be surprised if his laptop makes it through this research project right now. Mm-hmm. We'll see. If I have to duck off and use the fire extinguisher that I keep next to me at all times.
Well, just don't have him go to screenrant.com or movieweb.com or any of those where they fire up about 12 ads when you load a page, because that'll deep six the laptop in no time.
Oh, that's what I have him do. That's what his laptop is for. So I don't get any of that crap on my computer. That's what he's operating at dial-up speeds right now. Anyways, before
a peek behind the curtain.
Yeah, it ain't pretty, but you know it seems to work.
Right.
Before we get into our main topic, of course, we once again have our little tidbit buffet, if you will, of geekery and other things, which we call the Week in Geek. However, before we get to that, we have another sponsor.
Ah, and who might that be?
This episode's Week in Geek is sponsored by whatever the hell this crap is in my driveway from the storm that took place on my birthday. This demon combination of sleet, rain, snow, and apparently quick-setting concrete will probably show up in the fossil record for a million years from now, because it doesn't appear to be going anywhere, and it also makes life that much more miserable, which is saying something when you consider that most Americans already think Maine is a lesser-known province of Canada, so we really didn't need the help. Thanks, Mother Nature. What the hell did we ever do to you? Besides global warming and styrofoam and plastic. Well, never mind. Here's the Week in Geek.
The Week in Geek.
Feels so funky.
Well, thank you for that auspicious introduction.
Just like to keep it light and fun here. Light and fun, you know?
Well, speaking of light and fun, but before we get into our traditional trivia to start things off here and
anything to delay
Uncle
that,
Todd's
yes,
blood pressure,
please.
Let's take a step back and take a moment to acknowledge and celebrate Uncle Todd's birthday this past Friday.
Oh, yes. Thank you.
And so happy birthday, sir. And I think you got a special message from a member of the BSG crew, if I am not mistake.
I did. So it was very nice. It's always nice. You know, the one positive thing about technology today, or one of the positive things, because I'm not going to try and act like I'm some sort of Quaker hanging out, you know, in the field ranting about, you know, the evils of the typewriter or something. Actually, do they even care about type? Anyways, so, you know, is that you can get these messages on social media about, hey, happy birthday, and people text you and all that. And so I woke up to a couple texts, which was nice. You know, happy birthday, this and that. Hi, my name is Miranda. And if you need a bed part, who the hell are you? You know, so then I see one from Cameo. And like I said, I'm starting to get all these weird text messages anyways. Like now text spam is a thing. And everyone else was getting it way before I did, because I never texted that much. But now that I've picked up steam in my texting, I think that, you know, the spam gods, I've angered them. So now I'm starting to get these every so often of the weird, you know, like half written in Russian sort of, you know, do you like me? And this, I'm like, oh my gosh, hey, buy this thing. Sunglasses, like crap. Delete. So I see this one from Cameo and I'm like, and it's like, Tim got you a thing from Cameo. I'm like, this could be the risky click of the day. I better check with Tim to see if he actually did send me something, because it's very thoughtful. And I'm like, you're a very thoughtful guy. So I'm thinking there's a good possibility that this is legit. Mm-hmm. But I wanted to be sure, because I didn't want to all of a sudden have my bank account drained by like 11 a.m. on my birthday. And in fact, it was. And I got a very pleasant message from the chief, which was awesome. It was great. It was absolutely great. Aaron Douglas, you know, one of my favorite parts of BSG, because as we talked about in our pre-production meeting, the guy who kind of started off as a somewhat minor character. You know, I mean, sure, he had the whole thing with Sharon and all that, but then wound up becoming a much bigger part of the overall overarching story and all that. And a guy who really seems to just be like, he seems fine with just being known as Chief until like the end of his days. Like he's cool with that. Like, okay, if you want to call me Chief, whatever. I'm happy to be the Chief. And it was a very pleasant message and you know, very conversational and fun and all that. So it was very pleasant. So a very, very, very hearty thank you, sir. It definitely was a spirit lifter as I was looking at all of the muck that was accumulating outside of my house. Every time I started to get down about the weather, I would just go back and replay that message. I watched it like 5 times that day. I'm like, oh, I got to go out and do something with that. Hey, let's see that message from the chief again. Oh, it was great. So thank you, sir.
Oh, you're welcome. And also need to throw in there too a thank you to Mr. Aaron Douglas. And I appreciated when I filled out the description, as I said to Uncle Todd, I mentioned if he could, you know, relay some fun memories, some just stories from the show, and bonus points if he can include something about James Callis, because we are, if nothing else, big Baltar fans, as you've probably guessed from our past reviews of episodes and seasons and so forth.
No more Mr. Nice Guys!
And little did I know he would anchor onto that and throw us a trifecta of James Callis stories.
Started off the entire thing with the Baltar action figure. I didn't even know they made BSG action figures, and now I need these in my life.
Well, that's the Tyrell action figure, but he was pretending to be Baltar.
Oh, okay, because I didn't get a good look at it because he was kind of waving it around, and I'm looking at it on my phone, so I couldn't really tell. But yeah, he did. He was doing his James Callis Baltar impression, which was great.
It was.
Yeah,
and then
admonishing his own action figure. You don't sound anything like him. Stop. You know.
Yeah.
Oh, it was a tour de force performance, really.
Yeah, very, very down to earth, like you said, and it was. I was really, really happy with it. I thought he did a fantastic job and was just very, you know, down to earth. You know, very, very cool with the stories, and so yeah. So you are welcome, sir. Enjoy that. And
now,
one
thing I need to double check with you on, sir, though, is if I'm remembering right, he did mention that he might do the podcast. I heard that little bit in there, and I couldn't tell if he meant a podcast on his own or our podcast.
Well, what I wrote in the description is that you and I do a podcast for fun, and we talk about Battlestar. I didn't throw our name in there because I was getting a little concerned. I had noticed things about, like, I think Katie Sackhoff is on Cameo, and there was something about cannot do, like, you know, intros for podcasts or things like that. Like there was that was for her, though, not for him. But I didn't want to screw things up. So I just was like, yeah, I'm just going to mention we do this, that we talk about Battlestar. We'll see what he says. And he just brought it up. You know, he just, you know, thought it was cool we do one and talk about it. And
I gotcha.
Talked to his action figure like, are they going to talk about us? I think they will, sort of thing. So
and he's right.
And he's right, because, you know, it's the chief. We appreciate it. And it's always fun to have those kind of brushes with those that, you know, have performed in, you know, whether it be athletes in games or actors and actresses in entertainment and drama. It's always interesting to see them and hear from them as people. And like I said, he seems like someone you could sit down and have a couple drinks with and just, you know, laugh at a bunch of stories, because he's got a bunch of them. Big thank you to him.
Yes, indeed. And to you, sir. Once again, thank you very much.
You're welcome. Absolutely.
The only surprise I had was that you didn't get the Admiral on there, and it would just be like a 20-second message of like, you're getting older. This is a one-way trip, and that's it. And I would have been perfectly happy with that too. I would have been like, you know what? My life is complete. I've peaked. That's it.
Well, there's always next year, and boy, you just gave me a great idea. So, because if nothing else, I have very much enjoyed that speech towards the end of the series, and to get Edward James Olmos to do that in the perspective from the perspective of a birthday celebration. Oh my gosh, that'd be hysterical. That would be awesome. Very nice.
Not to pick out my own gift or anything, but you know, just sprinkling some ideas. That's all.
Indeed. And so we take this week in geek is very galactic oriented. So we're going to fly away from BSG and kind of bring ourselves around back over to the Red 5 trivia. So up on a high note, and for Uncle Todd, probably bring him down to a low note a little bit, but that's okay.
No, because it's just, it doesn't matter. It just doesn't matter. I'm behind and I'm never coming back, because the guy with the book ain't going to get any answers wrong.
So what I tried to do is pick some questions that I assume neither of us would just know.
You know, just drop the facade and just let's get this thing over with.
Right.
Okay.
So
I apologize to our listeners for yet another segment that nobody cares about, but this, we're all going to help make Tim feel better about himself. Okay. So let's all rally round and just help Tim's ego here. Okay. All right. Proceed.
When Jimmy
sir.
Dice comes on, I think we should involve him in this, because I think he would also probably go 5 for 5 on a lot of this stuff. So we'll see.
Well, yeah, but that's legit. And again, you go 5 for 5 because, you know, you couldn't get one wrong. So,
well, you know how it is.
Mm-hmm.
All right.
After
4 rounds, the overall score is Man They Call Tim 15, Uncle Todd 10. We enter into round 5.
That's,
are you ready?
No, we're round 4. If we do 5 each time, and right?
So no, I said we did 4. We've done 4 rounds.
Okay. All right. Yeah, you're right. Never mind. I don't math, and I don't care about the score anyways. So just go right ahead. Sorry. I kind of blacked out there for a minute.
Oh, well, let me see. So you're saying, that's a good point. So 50, yeah, 15 would be 25. Yeah, just, I'm not quite sure how we got to the score we got to. Maybe we did. Did I not?
I don't either. And I don't really care. I'm behind and I'm never coming back. So
15. Yeah, I'm confused too.
I am the Brooklyn Brawler to your Hulk Hogan right now.
All right,
now,
well, so anyways, let's just get going. I'll have to go back and find out how we have more points than questions, because I'm not doing any sort of weird math with this. It's 1 point for a right answer and 0 for a wrong. So, anyways.
Well, it's that Chicago voter math that's really kind of messing you up.
Well, that might be. All right, so round 5. Here we go. Question number 1. According to legend, who could use the dark side of the Force to create life? A. Darth Sidious. B. Darth Bane. C. Darth Plagueis. Or D. Darth Maul.
B. Darth Plagueis.
Letter C. All right. That is what I put as well, and that is the correct answer.
Oh, imagine that.
Well done. All right. Question number 2. Who, along with Tarful, escorted Yoda to an escape pod after the battle on Kashyyyk? A. Chewbacca. B. Salperin. C. Maru Maru. Or D. Lachichuk. I love these names.
I hate you so much. Chewbacca.
Okay. That is what I answered as well, and that is correct. That is in Revenge of the Sith, when Yoda is on Kashyyyk and the Imperials are overrunning. Question number three. Mm-hmm. Now, this is one I picked that I had literally no idea and just guessed on, because I honestly had no idea. So question number three. Who carries a Relby K-23 blaster pistol?
What the crap is this?
We're on equal footing here, my friend. A, rebel soldiers. B, Bespin security guards. C, snow troopers. Or D, Imperial officers. Who carries a Relby K-23 blaster pistol?
I ought to punch you right in the mouth.
And I'll tell you what I put for my guess was Bespin security guards.
And where's Bespin? Like, what is that?
Oh, Cloud City.
Okay.
Lando.
And how would we know this?
Well, if you'd like a little hint, I mean, if you think about when you see rebel soldiers or Imperial officers, what are they typically carrying? Are they carrying a rifle or a pistol?
Most often a rifle.
So that means of elimination.
It's either the Bespin dudes or what was the other option?
Snowtroopers.
I'm going to guess the Bespins then. Because the only one I really remember having a pistol is the bike troopers, right?
Yes, correct.
So yeah, let's go with the Bespin dudes.
All Nando's right, so you're going to go with what I guessed, and believe it or not, we got it correct. Process of elimination worked.
Look at you. You're giving me a sympathy hit this time.
I wouldn't call it sympathy. I would call it more, you know, fairness.
Why start now?
Question number four. What did the Rebel Alliance use on Hoth to allow its transports to get past the Imperial blockade? A, cloaking devices. B, a plasma cannon. C, an ion cannon. Or D, a planetary turbolaser.
C, ion cannon.
Oh, very nice. And that is the correct answer, an ion cannon. Well done, sir. You are 4-for-4. Wow, look at you.
And you're 4-for-4 as well, so I'm gaining no ground.
I know, but hey, look at this. You are
I know,
showing your knowledge.
It's not about you.
You're showing your knowledge. All right, last question. Who used an EE3 blaster rifle? A, Boba Fett. B, this character's name is 4-LOM in all caps, 4-LOM. C, Zuckus. Which I don't know if that's a real bounty hunter or someone took, you know, Zuckerberg's name and did that with it. Or D, Bosk. Who
I'm
used
go
an EE3 blaster rifle?
Boba Fett. That's the only one. It's the only name I recognize.
That is what I went with as well, and believe it or not, that is the correct answer. So, congratulations, sir! You went 5-for-5 on this week's Red 5.
Yay!
Yay!
Not
so our
really.
Overall is, let's see, we're at 2010, we're now at 25-15, so you're still 10 off the pace, but that's not to say you can't make the comeback at another time.
All right. Against the guy who's got the book with all the answers.
Oh,
yet again.
Stop it.
Would not be putting money on that one. No siree. No, right. Sir. I would not.
Next week, I'm going to try to find some really obscure stuff, and it's going to be Guess City, and we're going to see who can guess and be the closest to being right.
And again, you're going to be the one who has the answers.
That Bespin question was a process of elimination. I walked you through my logic. You came to the same conclusion. Had nothing to do with the answer key, my friend.
Or it's turning the book upside down, reading the answers at the bottom of the page.
I did that
one
after
two.
I put my answer down. I did that
Who
after
knows?
I put my answer down.
So, okay.
All right. Mm-hmm. Well, we'll move on from the Red 5, and now we got to talk. Oh, boy. We got to talk about Chapter 6 of Book of Boba Fett, because, Nelly, this was a Star Wars fan's dream come true.
Not really. There's a lot of people who are still managing to rain on their own parades, but I'll hang on to that for a little bit. But yeah,
well,
this one kind of blows out of the water. Like any of those, like, hey, do you think this person will make it, will show up? It's like the answer to that question is, yup, everybody's showing up.
Yeah.
Everybody is showing up. Hey, who is it? That person who was an extra? It wouldn't surprise me if they said, oh yeah, and Wicket was in the background of when the little spider things are roaming around. Sure, why not? Everybody was in this one. Between the last two episodes, like, everybody has shown up.
And I think what was most impressive for me is just to see how much they use deepfake Luke to, you know, at least when we saw him at the end of season two, it was kind of a controlled kind of interaction where there didn't have to be a lot of focus on his face and talking and all that stuff. And so I just assume they did it that way because while they could do that, there might be limitations, you know, when it comes to speaking and, you know, trying to map all that out. And boy, they went full. I'm now understanding, I think, why that speeder bike chase in Tatooine a few episodes back was as low budget as it was, because they probably dumped all the budget into this to get it all like looking pretty and nice, because man, I'm looking at this like it is like Mark Hamill back in, you know, 1983 is teaching Grogu, and part of new content, and it was incredible. It was so well done. And then, you know, if that wasn't enough, then they bring Ahsoka in, which I'm just like, oh my gosh.
Yeah. Didn't see that one coming.
Oh, jeez. Nope. Oh, and you know, the fan base, as many may complain about, oh, where's Boba Fett? This is supposed to be his series. I feel like the complaints are just a moving target at this point. It's like, you wanted it to be, you know, something interesting and tied to Mando. They're doing it, they're tying it into Mando, and we all knew this was kind of, you know, season 2.5 of Mando, and so now they're doing it and there's complaints about that, and now it's like we want more Boba Fett, and this isn't the best one. I've read is that all of this is, these last two episodes are a reaction by the directors and crew for all the complaining that's gone early on, and I'm like, do you think they're filming these in real time?
Yes,
it's like,
they
that
do.
Makes absolutely no sense at all that they're reacting to this. So
it's just because people don't understand how TV and movies actually work. You know, you don't sit there and shoot everything. I mean, well, some directors do. Some directors shoot everything, and then they have tons of stuff to go back through and edit and choose from and all that. Stanley Kubrick apparently was infamous for that. He would shoot like hundreds of takes of one scene, to the point where he would, like in The Shining, apparently, like, he was legit driving the actors crazy because he would keep shooting the same scene over and over and over and over again, like legit making them go nuts. Then there's people like Robert Rodriguez, which is why I don't think that you're seeing what these people think they're seeing. Robert Rodriguez famously, in his first feature film El Mariachi, basically shot no more than he absolutely had to, and kind of carried that through in his other movies even when he started shooting digitally, because he couldn't afford the film. Like he was shooting only what was absolutely necessary and kind of editing in his head as he went along, like, okay, I don't need any more of that, let's move on.
Which
is not something that I think has completely gone away with him. I think he still does that, even though he's not doing it. I don't think he's doing this series the way that he's done everything else, which is one of the reasons why I'm a little, it's tough for me to look at it as a Robert Rodriguez thing, because it's obvious that he's not the primary camera operator, which has always been his thing. Like him writing, shooting, editing, directing, the whole deal. But like this idea of like, oh no, they're changing stuff around. Like, dude, this stuff was locked in a long time ago. They're not going back and trying to edit this week to week.
Yeah.
Like, are you nuts? Like, this is a large production. There are so many moving pieces in this. You can't just go back and go, oh yeah, just edit that file. Like, no, it's not like that.
Yeah.
Like, that's not how these things work. There's millions of dollars involved in this.
Yeah.
Oh my gosh. Yeah. And people and the whole, like, oh, the two best episodes of Book of Boba Fett are the ones without Boba Fett. It's like, you know what? Just shut up. My gosh. Did anybody really think, I mean, maybe I was completely in a cocoon or under a rock or something, but when they announced Book of Boba Fett at the end of Mando season 2, did anybody else know this was coming?
Right.
Was I just the only person who didn't know and everyone else like, well, of course they're doing it. No, yeah. You didn't even know this was coming. This is like the nicest little surprise, like bonus you're going to get. And you're going to sit there and complain.
Yep.
Shut up. Enjoy it.
Yep.
Oh, my gosh.
Oh, yeah.
Again, like you cannot please some of these people. You cannot please them.
Nope.
It's so frustrating because it's like just in can't you who hurt you? Who hurt you? Show me on the droid. Where do they hurt you? Like what is so wrong in your life that you can't have like just more stuff that you loved as a kid and just kind of turn off that critical part of your brain and stop analyzing it like it's like I don't know what. Just enjoy. Nope. Yep. I've got to sit there and go on the internet and shut up.
Yeah.
Anyways, that's my thought on it.
Fascinated Uncle Todd.
I've just had enough of this stuff. It's like, I complain about things too, but at a certain point, like you have to enjoy some of this stuff for what it is.
Yeah.
And we didn't even know we were getting a Boba Fett series. So yeah, if it ends up being like 50% Boba Fett and 50% Mando, that's still a lot more Boba Fett than you ever thought you were going to get.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Shut your yap and enjoy it. And you know what? If Mando is a big part of Boba's story, okay. What's the problem with that?
Mm-hmm.
I don't get it. Like, it's not like you're being forced to watch like X-Men 3
right
over and over and over again. Or I mean, come on, just enjoy it. Ugh.
Yeah. It's very interesting. And you know, the other part of this too is, you know, just waiting until the entirety of this is over to just kind of look back across it all and kind of make a more informed critique of it rather than just doing it, you know, one episode at a time and so forth. I mean, this one starts off kind of where we left off. Mando's going to see Grogu and he arrives. Now I don't know if where they're at is I don't think it's Octo, the planet from the Rise of Skywalker and that trilogy, but I'm not entirely sure.
I kind of think it is, dude. I mean, because they showed, I saw a video where they showed like the Jedi Temple burning when Kylo Ren,
mm-hmm.
you know, that like part from wasn't Rise of Skywalker. It was The Last Jedi or whatever, this middle episode 8. They showed like back to back those two scenes. It looks like they went to a lot of trouble to make that building exactly the same on an exact same hill and to show the exact same like framing of the shot and everything that you would see in that movie. Like it seems like they went to a lot of trouble to double that. So I kind of feel, even though they haven't ID'd it yet, like I think that's the planet, dude.
Except for the fact that in, I think it was Force Awakens, they didn't know where he was, right? So I mean, if that's
that's after the Kylo Ren takes down the temple. That's after Luke has left.
Sure, but I'm saying Kylo could find him then, right? Kylo should know where he is.
Well, no,
Kylo didn't know where he was.
Exactly, because he went to the planet with the fish ladies on it, which is completely a different planet than this one. So the Jedi Temple is the one that he built. That's where Kylo Ren was trained, where all the new Jedis were being trained. And then after Kylo Ren, like, you know, firebug that whole thing, then Luke's like, peace out. I'm going way off the side of the map. And he went to that other planet. So I think it's that planet that Kylo Ren took out the Jedi there. That's the planet that he's on.
So
now
you're saying they're on Octo, but this wasn't where the Jedi Temple was being built. Cause I thought that's what they were building we're seeing the beginnings of his temple being built.
Well, it is, but the building, the planet that Rey goes to where they find Luke Skywalker is totally different than this planet. This is because that's where the original Jedi Temple was.
Oh, okay. Then we're saying the same thing. Yeah.
Maybe, I guess. I just don't know the name. I don't know the names of the planets. So I'm just
I don't
saying,
know the like, name of this one either. So
they haven't ID'd it yet.
Right. Right. And I just found it hard to believe that was the one where she finds him at, because then how can he hide? So.
Yeah.
But yeah. Yeah. But yeah, we start to see the beginning of the temple being built with those crazy looking ant droids, which is, you know, which is pretty funny because they're not like the size of ants. They're just like, you know, up to scale. And you know, just that scene where he walks into the clearing and they're just like all like just going back and forth, like stacking rocks and doing stuff was just pretty funny to see. And they build him like a bench and he just kind of like, you know, chills out there. I thought that whole interchange between him and Ahsoka was great, you know, with that whole idea of, you know, you can go, you know, I really enjoyed how it was a total freedom thing. She's like, you can go and talk to him. You know, it's that whole parental reverse psychology. It's like, yeah, you can go have, you know, what you want, but, you know, just realize what the impact might be. And that was like enough to kind of steer him away from doing it and just kind of leaving his gift with her, and which would play a role later on, you know, at the very end. But no, I just thought it was kind of cool to see all those characters together. I mean, I've seen on Twitter a few screenshots of just that scene of, you know, Mando and Ahsoka looking up at Luke and Grogu, and just the, you know, a lot of the comments are just like, did you ever think we would see these four characters together in the same frame? Which I would say, no, I would not have thought that.
Yeah. And then of course we got the return of Cobb Vanth. Timothy Olyphantastic showing back up. Yep. and playing a great part, like just a very nice continuation of that character. And then of course we get the big reveal, because at first you're like, oh well, the stranger out of the desert, of course Cobb Vanth, now we're gonna bring him back in.
No.
We get the big reveal at the end, and we get ourselves some Cad Bane, who is like one of the most badass Star Wars characters. Like, I would say even almost more badass than Boba Fett.
Yeah.
When you get right down to it. Because, I mean, if you've watched Rebels, or I think he was in Clone Wars, hot minute.
Yeah.
But if you've seen either of those, like, you kind of understand, like, this dude's been around for a while, and there's a long trail of bodies behind him.
Yeah.
And, it's an interesting thing to pull him in too, because now it's like, oh my gosh, who aren't they bringing in at this point? And it's great. Oh, it's fan-freaking-tastic.
It is. It is. And we now know he's tied to the syndicate. He's kind of the muscle. It will be interesting to see if we end up finding out if he's the one who in fact wiped out the Tusken Raider tribe and not the biker gang, because of the fact that, you know, if he's kind of out there roaming in the desert and he's acting on behalf of the syndicate, they may have used the biker gang as kind of a front to, you know, misdirect Boba Fett on, you know, taking out his rage. And in fact, maybe he did them a favor by taking out that biker gang, to be perfectly honest.
It could all be part of the plan, because it seems like the Pikes are much, much more devious than kind of what was shown early on.
Yes, absolutely.
Much more sophisticated.
Yes. So that'll be interesting. And of course, we only have one chapter left. And so I'm still hanging on to, from our real and Jabroni, you know, we see Mando with Boba and Fennec Shand and the whole crew planning out what their next move is. I'm still holding out hope that we're going to have a reuniting of the bounty hunters to go against Cad Bane and the Pikes. So getting Bosk, getting IG-88, getting Dengar, you know, along with everyone. I'm wondering if they're going to build to that sort of, you know, high noon standoff sort of thing with all of these, you know, kind of gunslinging characters, and it just turns into a space Western, you know, kind of shootout sort of thing between them all. Would be extremely cool with I think where it's going to go is Mando against Cad Bane or Boba Fett against Cad Bane. You know, to, you know, kind of have that one-on-one sort of, duel, but just an amazing episode. It was really cool to see the whole training of Grogu and, you know, some callbacks to past, you know, characteristics of him with, you know, when he's seeing the frogs and trying to use the Force to bring the frogs to his mouth, and Luke showing him, you know, basically Luke kind of being Yoda to him in the same way, you know, Yoda was to Luke, and, you know, taking things like that and showing him what could be with, you know, proper application of his skills in the Force and all of that was just really, really interesting. And so, So no, I just, you know, the last two episodes along with the whole series has just been been top to bottom fantastic, and very excited to see what lies ahead for us in the final chapter.
Yeah, and the one thing I'm kind of surprised that more folks aren't teeing off on a little bit more is Luke kind of being a jerk in a way. Mm. Like that whole like, hey, you got to choose one or the other. Like, I get it. And I think part of that comes down to like, oh, well, of course, it's a Jedi thing. Like, yeah, but he's also kind of being a jerk about this. Like, hey, kid, choose between your mom or your dad. Like that sort of thing. Like, yeah. And, you know, how is Grogu going to fit back into this? Because obviously, you know, that little dome there in the back of the Naboo starfighter is the perfect Grogu seat. And it's been in frame every time they show it. It's prominently featured. Yes. And it's just, how is he going to show up in the end of this? Because as we've seen, you know, he kind of will come out of nowhere and do some really crazy stuff. Like we saw it with that rhino kind of thing in the first season. Now, what did he do in the second season? There was something else that he did that kind of really. No. Yes.
Yeah.
So yeah, just all the stuff that it's like, it's kind of feeling like it's building to that. Like Grogu is going to do something that's going to be like, oh wow.
Yeah. Yeah.
And then also at this point, because you've thrown the Darksaber in, I mean, are they just going to continue to be like, hey, and here's some more, like, are we going to get Bo-Katan showing up to kind of show you something about, cause I mean, they spent a lot of time talking about Bo-Katan Kreese. And how she was a cautionary tale, and the, you know, I mean, we spent a good portion of one episode dealing with Darksaber.
Yeah.
And I get it, like that'll be perfect if it leads into Mando season 3, but I don't know. Like, are we heading towards another, you know, another like just, hey, let's bring everybody in. Yeah. Everybody. You know? I don't know. It's gonna be interesting, and I cannot wait until Wednesday.
Yes.
It's gonna be a lot of fun.
Yes, it will. And you know, and just to throw one more thing in there, just the way they're weaving the characters in. I mean, we're used to seeing this sort of thing in like the animated shows, and you know, I don't know what it is about live action, but it is just really fun as a fan to see the way they're just very seamlessly weaving all these characters together. It doesn't feel out of place. It doesn't feel forced. It feels very organic to the nature of the story and the characters and what's going on. And so, I'm super excited to see this Wednesday what lies ahead for us and where this all goes, because it's leading to Mando season 3, which we still don't have a date on yet. So hopefully we get an idea of when that'll be.
Yeah. So now if I'm actually let me take a moment here and look this up. So Mandalorian, come on now. So the Mandalorian was, I think that was 8 episodes, wasn't it?
Each
season?
So. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, cuz they're showing 24, so that's obviously including season 3. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, so each of those was, do you think that we are heading for like a double episode here for chapter 7? Like they just decided like we're not going to, this last one is going to be a double dose.
Like a 90-minute ordeal?
I kind of wonder, because
could be
7 episodes. I don't know. It seems a little odd, and it seems like there's a whole lot to tie up in like 40 to 45 minutes.
Yep. Yeah.
Like even if you kind of, and the thing is with streaming, you don't have to worry so much about, oh, does it fit into the standard time blocks? Like
right.
You can kind of do whatever. I feel like we're heading towards at least 60 minutes. If I think we might be heading towards that hour and a half, like double episode time. I don't know. I'm hoping, but that's just could mostly because I just want me some more. I want all of it. I mean, all of it.
There's a lot to wrap up, you know? I mean, there's a fair amount to wrap up with this. It's not, I mean, you know, we talked about the eventual, you know, Pikes versus Fett's family sort of face off, but there's a lot of other stuff getting woven in there as well. And, you know, I don't think it's a mistake they spent as much time with Grogu as they did and Luke. Who knows? We may have Luke and Grogu jumping into the fray as well. It's really hard to say. You know,
isn't that going to be awkward with Boba Fett? Like, hey, Like everyone talking about, there's a reason why Boba Fett peaced out in the finale of season two of Mando, because it's just like, how do you deal with that? We've already got enough else going on. We don't need that awkward experience. Like, hey, you remember that? Let's not talk about that sort of thing.
Yeah.
Like I would actually appreciate a huge battle scene. Everything comes down, the dust settles, and you just see Luke kind of look over at Boba and Boba look at Luke like, we good? We cool? We cool?
That would be hysterical.
And that's just the sum total of it. Like that. Yeah, we're cool. Yep. Okay, good. Yep. That would be great. Probably not going to happen, but hey, I can dream.
One can dream. Yes. And that's, my friends, is a very extended week in Geek.
Yes, sir. Well, once again, thank you for surfing the interwebs and finding, well, there wasn't all that much to find because we really just talked about stuff that we were already going to talk about anyways. Indeed. And thank you once again for the cameo and thank you for bringing me down with the Star Wars trivia once again. That's just, I look forward to it every week.
I bet you do.
Now we are going to get the topic at hand. Finally, after years. Gosh. And we've been listening to how the reports of Tom Brady's demise now for well over a decade. Like people have been talking about how his career was going to end, his system quarterback, he's going to drop off, he's going to this, he's going to that, for how many years at this point? Well, it's finally over because now the man himself is calling it quits. Mm-hmm. And arguably, it's really like he is doing this on his terms because he could continue to play. Mm-hmm. I mean, there's nothing about his stats that are that like god awful. I mean, where is he at here this past season? I mean, well, let me see here. What are we doing? This is, I don't want that. I want the season stats. Here we go. So this season, 485 completions, 67.5% completion rate, 5,316 yards, which is, jeez, I believe, that is his career high. 43 touchdowns, which is nothing to sneeze at. It's above his career, it's above his career average. I mean,
yeah,
this is not a guy who is tailing off.
No.
Very, very easily could keep playing for another couple of years. And even when he does start to tail off, his tail, unless he just drops off the shelf, like kind of Peyton Manning did, he could continue to do this for a couple more years and just make some of these stats even more unreachable than what they are, but he isn't. Yeah. So kind of going out on his own terms, unfortunately, you know, for him, not with that Super Bowl. So he's not getting the full John Elway treatment, but we are finally seeing the end of Tom Brady's career, which quite honestly, I didn't know that we would ever do this show.
Yeah.
Because it seemed to me like this was always going to be the thing. Like Tom Brady is just going to keep coming back and eventually it will be Keith Richards, Vince's head in a jar, and Tom Brady. And that's going to be the end of time. And it's going to be a three-way battle for, you know, who's going to have superiority. It'll be like the Highlander, except it'll be those three dudes. Well, I mean, those two dudes and a head in a jar. I'll leave it to you to break down whether or not that jar gives Vince an advantage or not. I don't know. I'm still kind of split on that. Tom Brady is finally calling it quits. And so we are going to kind of break this down. But I feel the need to give the resume because some of this stuff is just so absolutely incredible that it defies really description, especially when you consider this is a guy who was drafted 199th in like the second to last round of the NFL draft. Mm-hmm. So he doesn't quite have like the Troy Brown distinction of being drafted in a round where they don't even have that in the draft anymore. Like he was drafted in whatever round and they were just like, you know what? Don't even bother having more than this many rounds because ain't nobody sticking around after that. Mm-hmm. And couldn't even hold on to his starting job in college. Like, we're not talking about Heisman Trophy winner Tom Brady. We're talking about the dude who is constantly in a battle to keep the starting job at Michigan.
Yeah.
And, I mean, Michigan, I'm just going to say it, not exactly the cradle of college quarterbacks. Like, it's what, Tom Brady and Jim Harbaugh and I don't know. Someone else can maybe fill me in on the other great Michigan quarterbacks. Yeah. Drew Stanton, I think, back in the day.
I'm like not Drew, a big college the first, football Drew nut, so I will be of little help here.
Yeah, but for but what I'm trying to get at is like for that guy to turn into this guy, nobody had money on this. Like even Bill Belichick has gone back and said, like, if we knew, because people would always, oh, well, what a great pick you made. And this night, and even Bill Belichick in kind of a rare moment of kind of clarity or in candor is like, hey, if we knew he was that good and waited that long to draft him, we should all be fired. True enough. You know, we waited like five rounds before we picked this guy. Anyone else could have had him. So let's run this down. As a quarterback, 7 Super Bowl championships, which is the most of any NFL player in history. 10 Super Bowl appearances, which is the most, and oddly enough, second is Steven Gostkowski.
Oh, interesting.
He has 5 Super Bowl MVPs, which is the most, second to which the second place is Joe Montana with 3. Some of these I don't think are going to be broken. Like, I don't think you're ever going to see anyone win an individual win 5 Super Bowl MVPs ever again. I just don't. 3 NFL MVPs. He is he actually is trailing Peyton Manning, who has the most, but he is tied with, and there are some luminaries in here and one schmuck. He is tied with Jim Brown. Yes, ladies and gentlemen, that Jim Brown, Johnny Unitas, Brett Favre, and Aaron Rodgers. And everyone else who has 2 is retired. So no one's really coming close to this anytime soon. Overall, in completions, he has 7,263. He is first overall. Now we're going to get into who could possibly catch him. Well, the closest active player to him is Matt Ryan, who is in 7th with 5,242.
Holy moly.
Ain't no way Matt Ryan is catching Tom Brady. Matt Ryan is probably like another year or two from retiring himself. He is first in pass attempts with 11,317. Again, Matt Ryan is 9th with 8,003. He is first in passing yards with 84,520. Matt Ryan is 8th with 59,735.
I'm surprised Drew Brees isn't in any of this. It's all Matt Ryan. Wow.
Well, he is. When I'm just talking about active quarterbacks. Drew Brees retired. Like, there's other guys who are closer. Certainly.
Didn't he retire this year, though? Like, same time as Brady, roughly?
No, he retired last year, dude.
He was last year. Oh, okay. Yeah, he's an analyst this year. Okay.
Yeah. Gotcha. So, I mean, but that's the closest technically active quarterback. But then you have a long ways between Matt Ryan and like the next guy who is not going to retire within the next 1 to 3 years.
Yeah. Yeah.
This next one is interesting. So he is first in passing touchdowns with 624. Aaron Rodgers is the next active quarterback closest with 449.
Interesting.
He's 5th. However, I think the best chance, this is actually one of the ones that I think might have the best chance of being broken. Passing yards, maybe as well, just where people are throwing, you know, it used to be like when you threw for 4,000 yards, it was like, oh my gosh, that's incredible, like stupid numbers. Now it's like, 4,000 yards is like 3 or 4 guys who do that every year now. It's like when you hit 5,000, that's the new, oh my gosh. And even that is now becoming kind of a normal thing for, you know, the best of the best to get to. So the touchdowns, though, with a ball in the air so many times, I think it's interesting. So Patrick Mahomes, just to give you an idea of like one of the young quarterbacks who could stick around and possibly be like in contention to break some of these records. Patrick Mahomes would have to play 16 seasons and he'd have to average 38 touchdowns per year to tie Tom Brady.
Interesting.
16 years, dude. And right now he's averaging 38 touchdowns per year in his career. So, I mean, if he stays on that pace, he could tie in another 12 years.
Wow.
Now you tell me the problem there is Mahomes is a quarterback who likes to run a bit. Like, is there a chance that he plays 16 years? That's the thing. Like, who can hang around long enough and be good enough that long to even come close to any of these?
Yeah. Longevity is going to be key.
Yeah. So here's what I throw in just for fun. He rushed for 1,124 yards in his career.
The gazelle he did.
like Julian Edelman said, everyone likes to watch the Clydesdale run. And it really, he did. He looked like a Clydesdale running. Like, those are some hoofs on that dude. He wasn't moving too quick. So basically, like, what would be considered kind of a better than average running back's, like, yearly numbers, that's Tom Brady in his career. That's a whole lot of those, like 1 yard quarterback keepers. However, that 1,100 yards was good for 27 touchdowns and 233 first downs.
Wow.
So he made those 1,100 yards count for sure.
Yeah. Yeah.
He is
I'm just
second.
Floored. I'm floored. He got over 1,000 yards rushing though. That's incredible.
I know. Which is funny that it took him 22 years to do that.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, I think it makes sense because I was going to say his rushing, you know, has to average somewhere between 1 and 3 yards. You know, it's not like he's going for 12 or 15 constantly, right? So.
Well, yeah, and it might even be less because when you factor in. Like if you go for overall offensive numbers, you take away all the yardage he lost in sacks and tackles behind the line of scrimmage. So if you actually took away all of the sacks, that it takes away his entire rushing total.
Jeez.
Like and then some, because I think he had something like 84,000 yards of, so he had 84,000, and his overall offensive numbers were like 82,000. I was like, how'd that happen? He had 84. I'm like, oh, the sacks. So even when you add his rushing numbers onto his passing numbers, he lost like 3,000 some odd yards in sacks over his career. Like he is one of the most sacked quarterbacks in history. I think Ben Roethlisberger has more, but that's because he's been around for 22 years.
Yeah.
So, he is second in game-winning drives with 53. Peyton Manning had 54, which is kind of aggravating. Second fourth quarter comebacks with 42. Peyton Manning had 43. Again, kind of aggravating. He is eighth all-time in games played with 318 games played. And basically, he's behind only kickers, like the Morton Anderson and whatever, like the Anderson boys are ahead of him, and George Blanda. And George Blanda, of course, was quarterback / kicker, of course, later in his career, pretty much just mostly a quarterback. So it's only kickers who have been ahead. So like he is the only guy who's managed to play this many games and not just have to go out there and kick the ball.
Yeah.
However, he is first in games started with 316.
Interesting.
So that, ladies and gentlemen, and the funny part is that Tom Brady was officially named the NFL QB GOAT, greatest of all time, by Football Reference. In 2022, I'm like, it took that long for them to be like, yeah, I guess he's better than Manning. Like, really? Really? You kind of just delegitimized yourself there, fellas.
Which was the big debate for much of the early part of his career, because he was, of course, contemporaries with Peyton. And Peyton was...
Oh, not only contemporaries. I mean, he was direct competition, like a division rival for the first few years.
Yeah. Yep.
And then a direct conference rival.
Yeah. And there was just that constant comparison. And I just remember how frustrating those years were, because Brady would do more with less. And the press was so enamored with Manning and this narrative of him being, you know, like I think at the end of the day, they wanted him to be what Brady became. Like Manning was supposed to be, you know, this once in a lifetime or once in a generation sort of quarterback. And, you know, don't get me wrong, Manning posted, you know, amazing stats. He had an incredible career. But, you know, given what Brady was working with, I would say in a lot of ways, Brady was, like I said, doing more with less and winning more, you know, and able to win, you know, those big games. And, you know, Manning had his moments, but, you know, Brady and the Patriots got in the way of a lot of that. But the press wanted to have, you know, the narrative was Manning was always going to be the better quarterback. And so it's frustrating, but yet interesting that it took this long for it to get declared. So.
Well, and I think it just points out the fact that first of all, comparing quarterbacks directly, you know, like, oh, this guy versus this guy, it's not, you know, it's not really those two guys competing, because Tom Brady isn't on the field ever at the same time as Peyton Manning was, and vice versa. It's really the team around those quarterbacks and the organization around those quarterbacks and how they are setting them up for success. And ultimately, you know, people can talk about Bill Belichick, the Patriot, you know, the Patriot way, and I'm using my air quotes there, and all, you know what? It worked.
Yeah.
It worked. And it's still working, you can argue. Because I mean, you had a team that had the best quarterback in the NFL, even when he left, was still in the conversation. Like, his stats did not show it. He had obviously was not capable of doing the same with less as he was when he started out, but still one of the best ones there. And they had one down year and then rebounded.
Yep.
And which has been what they've done over the years. Like, that, this team has gone through like three or four major rebuilds without taking that major step back of just being down in the cellar and then clawing their way back up. They've been competitive all the way through for two decades. Mm-hmm. Obviously that works. Now, Manning, they had a great way of approaching it. They built him an offensive line that it was really hard for anybody to get to Manning. Like, they protected their asset, and they gave him they had Edgerrin James. They always had a fairly decent running back behind him, even after Edgerrin James retired. Always gave him good targets, and then it ended up kind of skimping on the defense. The Patriots kind of went at it a different way, and either both those teams had success, but ultimately the Patriots are the one who managed to have more success. And it's really about those methods of building a team and maintaining a franchise. And you know, it between their prep and just the way that the cookie crumbles, some luck, whatever you want to call it, one came out on top.
Indeed.
And it wasn't the ones with the shoehorn, with the horseshoe on the helmet. Sorry.
Yep.
Sorry, not sorry. No participation banner at Gillette. Well, I guess they did. They kind of did with that undefeated season banner, but still, at least it wasn't like, you know, AFC championship game participant, whatever the banner that they hung up, that was like, oh, that's embarrassing. Like, all the players must have been like, can we just take that down, seriously? this is tough enough.
Oh yeah.
So we're gonna go through and kind of give our top five TB12 moments and games here. And I'll let you start off. So, starting with our five and heading up towards one, what have you got in the five spot, sir?
Well, before I jump into five, I just had two special mentions that did not make it into the top five, but just wanted to bring them up. Had to in some way, like basically my top five are all Super Bowl matchups, but I had to at least mention the 2007 season where Tom Brady went full Tecmo Bowl with Randy Moss against Miami 1 week there and put up six TDs in one game. Just incredible between the two of them. And then I was reminded as I was going through and kind of researching different games, the 2007 final regular season game against the Giants, where both Brady and Moss broke records for passing and receiving touchdowns and cemented the Patriots as the first undefeated regular season team since the 72 Dolphins. Just a couple special mentions there from that season. Although we very much remember how that season ended up, and we'll prefer not to discuss that. So,
although you got to admit, Eli Manning ought to be sending Tom Brady Christmas cards for the rest of eternity.
Mm-hmm.
Because, and the fact is, like, one of those games, I can't remember which one, I think it was the 2007 Super Bowl, where Brady had that, I think he had the safety early. Mm. Like, there was definitely some plays that he made in those, but really both of those games, man, especially the 2007 one where Eli was totally in the grasp, should have been called down. Like, in any other game, they blow the whistle to protect the quarterback. They don't. He slips out after being like in the grasp for a good 5 seconds, you know?
Yeah.
And then, you know, and then they also had, I think they had Ellis Hobbs on Plexico Burris, which I'm like, yeah, that's a good idea. Yeah, that's going to work out real well.
What could that was one of those.
That was one of those seasons when it was like Bill Belichick was just trying to prove that he could win with like Earthwind Moreland. You remember that guy? Mm-hmm. Like they never carried more than like two cornerbacks, and then they'd have to go and pick guys up who had like shifts at Dunkin' Donuts that they had to get off so they could come play in Foxborough.
Yep.
Like that, those years when Troy Brown was coming in and covering slot receivers, like couldn't we just like carry a couple extra of these guys? Cause it seems like they're getting hurt every single year.
Yeah.
It was kind of more of a defensive breakdown on both of those game, both of those games, I feel, than necessarily Brady losing the game. But I do appreciate the fact that when he retired, the New York papers were like, Tom Brady, who is responsible for two giant Super Bowls.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, retires. I was like, you know what? Go on with your bad self. That's, you got that. You got one more chance to do it. Go ahead. Just go ahead.
Yep.
It's fine. You know, I've learned to live with it. But absolutely. It is funny when you consider that of the two Manning brothers, the black sheep Manning brother is the one who managed to have the most success against Tom Brady on the biggest stage. Yeah. Who would have thunk it, you know?
In the words of Roman Reigns, welcome to the island of relevancy.
Yes. Kinda.
Yes.
Because Eli Manning was, I mean, he was a good quarterback. He was a good quarterback, but without those two Super Bowls, he is essentially like a Jay Fiedler plus. Yeah. Like he's one of those guys that would have, hey, great game, really bad game, great game, really bad game.
Mm-hmm.
And just make some of these plays where you're like, what the hell? How did you get into the NFL doing something that stupid?
Yeah.
And then he would also have these amazing things that would happen. So he's a very interesting case study.
Yes.
And someone who is, because of those two Super Bowls, is going to be in the Hall of Fame.
Yeah. Absolutely.
And really, that's like on the strength of those two games, which is hilarious and terribly sad. Oh, where's my bourbon?
Oh, yes.
Anywho, thanks for bringing that up.
Yeah, no worries. My number five, though, was Super Bowl 38, where the Patriots defeated the Panthers 32-29. I just remember this being a back and forth game, as a lot of the early Patriots Super Bowls were. They were never... undoubtedly in question that they were going to win. It was always kind of down to the wire. And Brady was an MVP for that game, went 32 of 48, 354 yards, three TDs, one in. Hey, he had two rushes for 12 yards. So we know he could do it. But most notable for this one was this was the first time where Belichick broke out the old defensive tackle as a tight end maneuver with Mike Vrabel lining up on a goal line, potential goal line touchdown, and Brady throwing to him. I think it was completely in the clear. I don't think he was being covered at all. And it was just one of those, moments that kind of cemented not only, Brady being as good as he is, but for Belichick being just the strategist who's like, he just wheeled out a defensive tackle and just totally embarrassed him, which will later be used against him when we move up the list here, because I have a game where that gets whipped out and used against them. But nonetheless, number five for me was Super Bowl 38. It was a close game, exciting game, but in the end, as I would used to post on the Facebook, Brady victorious, as he brought them back from the brink and closed it out 32-29.
Yeah, and that was another game where what was the guy's receiver's name? Crap. But he was also a receiver on the Rams the first year, and he was it Prohl?
Might have been. I don't remember though.
But if you remember the first when they went to the Super Bowl against the Rams and the Rams were making their comeback, he was one of the guys who made like this incredibly clutch play, like catch and run to get a first down. And then he did it again with the Panthers. And I'm watching that game and I'm just like, no, not this freaking guy again.
Yeah.
Like, no, I don't need this in my life. And that was always a funny thing. Like we talked about this before. Like we never really got like that Super Bowl where you're like, you can kick back in the third quarter and just kind of enjoy the ride. Like that last one against the Rams was about as close as you get.
Yeah.
But every other Super Bowl was just like, right down to the end, like I don't need this stress in my life. Like the Patriots Super Bowls probably took about 5 years off of my life in terms of stress. I mean, I'm okay with that, but still, Ugh.
Yeah.
But yeah, good pick there.
And what is your
for me? I'm I'm going to go with Super Bowl 55. You went all Patriots. I'm actually going to throw in the final Super Bowl of Brady's career. This was the Buccaneers 31 over the Chiefs 9. This is his seventh win and one of his most efficient games ever. You know, three touchdowns, not a ton of yardage, but I think he was like 21 of 29 passing. Just a very efficient game and just kind of taking care of business. Like, there was no frills about it. And, you know, he just took care of business and got the thing done. Yeah. And at the end of the day, to me, that is one of the things that I'll remember for Brady. Like, it wasn't necessarily the flashiness. Like, he would have moments when, yeah, he could bomb the ball. I mean, we saw it with Moss. Like, everyone talked about, oh, he's a system quarterback, just throws those screens and this and that. He's like, oh yeah, give me someone who I can just huck it up there and he can run under it like a gazelle.
Yeah.
And I can do that too.
Yeah.
And, you know, it's, you know, he would just get the job done. Yeah. That's just how his entire career was. And I think that's part of the reason for success. It could be very businesslike and methodical. Just get the job done, however you have to do it. And so to me, it was a great game to watch. It was a little hard because, you know, as a Patriots fan, you're kind of hoping that that would be in a Patriots uniform, but not to be. And it was good to see him get the seventh win and really just kind of, I don't know if you could say cement him as the greatest of all time, because he was mm-hmm. already two ahead of any other quarterback yeah. at that point. I mean, I don't know what else you want,
yeah.
But you know, he did it. So that was my fifth pick.
One thing I'll just say is it is, you know, as frustrating as it was to watch that last year, because I had made that comment to you. We were texting during the game and that was something I said, is it's so frustrating to me to watch this. And it's like, now that he's not in a Patriots uniform, now he has the cruise control game. You know, it's like, why couldn't we have had at least one of those when he was with us, sort of thing.
Yeah.
Now, that's a minor thing to complain about, because as you aptly put it in the introduction here, for this episode, this is way more, you know, we ended up seeing more championships than the Patriots probably deserve to win under, you know, with him being on the team. So, you know, perspective, of course, with all of these sort of quote unquote complaints, but I do think it's poetic for him and his career that he had that moment, you know, that he had a game where the defense was, I mean, honestly, this was not expected to be this. The Chiefs were a high powered offense. They were going to, mm-hmm. you know, put up points, and it was more of a question of, could Tampa Bay keep up and could Brady, you know, manhandle on offense, at least, you know, the Chiefs defense and, you know, keep pace with Patrick Mahomes. Well, it went in a very different direction. Mahomes was the one who was trying to keep pace. And when that game got more and more out of reach, it, you know, he got more and more reckless. And so, I mean, it was an amazing game and he played his heart out, but it was one of those things where, you know, I just think Tampa Bay's defense was that much better. And mm-hmm. it was just for his career. And if, you know, since this is going to be his last Super Bowl victory, it was fitting that it be something that of a cruise control game for him, where, you know, he and the team worked hard, put up the numbers, put up the score, but at the end it was you know, the end of the game was never in doubt. So which is just a nice difference, you know, when just looking at how it usually went for the Patriots in a lot of these Super Bowl games where it was so close. So
yes, yep, agreed. So what do you got for your number four?
Number four, I kind of call this the, since our last episode was a bit of a Rocky-themed episode, this is kind of the Rocky II Creed versus Balboa matchup of Super Bowl, I believe it's 52, if I'm reading my Roman numerals correctly.
Wait a minute. Is it?
L-I-I? No. No?
Oh,
yeah, 52.
Yes, I'm sorry. I was looking at the one below that in your number five. I'm like, no, that isn't. Don't pay any attention to me. Yes, Super Bowl 52.
52. This is a loss for the Patriots, so this is not a victory for them. But
I'm putting this
one down because I just remember, you know, as much as the Panthers game was a back and forth game, this was the personification, if you will, of two heavyweight fighters just beating on each other constantly throughout the game. I mean, it was a tit for tat. Patriots would score. Philadelphia would score. It was back and forth constantly. Chicanery was pulled out when the Eagles pulled the Mike Vrabel bit on Belichick at the end of the first half. And
well, that and the Philly special.
And the Philly special, yep. Yep.
So really this is, to me, this is Rocky II, because it was the equivalent of Philly coming out and boxing yes. right-handed.
Yep. That was absolutely. The gimmick. That's what I said. It's Rocky II. It is Philadelphia's team winning, coming out, but it was a brutal back and forth, and they outlasted the kind of the defending champions, if you will.
Yeah. And like you said, one of arguably Brady's best statistical game ever. I mean, that is an incredible stat line. Incredible.
Yeah. So 28. Sorry, I got to read again here. 28 completions, 48 total attempts, 505 yards, 3 touchdowns, 1 rush for 6 yards. And overall, yeah, this is believed to be Brady's best statistical game in a Super Bowl overall. So even though they ended up as a loss, Nick Foles was the MVP, not Brady. Brady had a stellar night, and it just was not in the cards for the Patriots to win that night. And you know, honestly, it was one of those cases the next day at work when I was being given a hard time by a number of colleagues and a couple who are, from the Philadelphia area. You know, you just have to tip your hat. You know, it's like one of those things. Mm-hmm. It stinks your team doesn't win. I said, we've won several before, which makes this a little bit easier to take. But at the same time, you guys played a heck of a game, and it's like,
oh, yeah,
you can't be upset by that. You know, it's one thing when you play, like we talked about with the Giants in 2008, and there's just this expectation that the Patriots are going to roll over them, and expectations are greatly, upended by the way that game went. Whereas in this one, we knew this was going to be a back and forth. I mean, Nick Foles was on a tear, on a run, and we've seen this before with Brady, except it being Brady who's on a tear. And so we knew this was going to be a tight one, and it just turned out to be it was a phenomenal game to watch. I just remember it was like, that was an amazing football game to watch.
Yeah, it's tough to be upset about that. Like, you just got outplayed. You got beat. And it wasn't like you got,
indeed.
It's easy to get upset about, the Giants games, partially because like that, especially that first one, like I pointed out, some of the weird stuff that just seemed to happen. And then of course, just being aggravated because you're like, oh, for God's sake, how did we get this long into the season? And Ellis Hobbs is our top, shutdown, big old air quotes over that one, shutdown corner to go against, this guy who's a good foot and a half taller than him, for crying out loud. Oh, my gosh. Unless you can go out there and stand on a milk crate, Ellis Hobbs is not going to be batting anything down from Plexico Burris. Anyways.
Yeah.
In this one, it just went back and forth. Like, you had every opportunity to win, and it just didn't work that way.
Yep.
Can't get upset with that. Yeah, you're right.
And ironically, your number 4 is?
Yes, I actually changed this one up because I love symmetry. So I'm going to go with Super Bowl 39, which is the happier ending to the Patriots-Philly saga, which is Patriots 24, Eagles 21. This is the Donovan McNabb puke game, ladies and gentlemen. Oh my gosh, this is where Andy Reid just kind of was in full flower of like the guy who is like Marty Schottenheimer plus, like he's going to get you right to the door, and then just the whole thing is just going to fall apart with a whimper and a fart. It was just amazing. Like this is the third Super Bowl that the Patriots had played in the Brady Belichick era. It was the second of the back-to-back 14-2 seasons. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. At this point, the first two Super Bowls they played in had both gone down to the wire, come down to like a game-winning drive and a kick. So you're figuring, I mean, you would think as an opposing coach, like, probably going to be a close game. We better make sure that we've got our hurry-up offense down. We got our two-minute drill, that our kicker is in. We know where everything is going to happen because these guys play close games. Not to mention, like, that this was their MO. Like, they would just outplay you. You'd play 59 minutes. They played 60 minutes. That was their thing.
Yeah, yeah.
Andy Reid, in his infinite wisdom, did not practice the two-minute drill leading into this game. So that's why they're like kind of schlepping along at the end of the game, and there's no hurry up. Like, there's no urgency whatsoever in this game. And it's talked about, like, oh, Donovan McNabb was tired or he was feeling sick or whatever. It's like, but then for the head coach to come out afterwards and say, well, I didn't practice we didn't really work on the 2-minute drill.
Oh, geez.
Andy Reid should never have gotten another coaching job after that. Mm-hmm. Like, I'm not trying to, like, the man has had a great career and he's going to be he's going to go down with, you know, one of the highest win totals ever. But my God, for that right there, I can't imagine how anyone would even think of interviewing him after that.
Yep.
That is one of those gaffes that you're just like, how did beg your pardon? You didn't what? Yeah. Absolutely crazy. Deion Branch is the MVP by Brady slinging the ball to him for 133 frickin' yards, which is funny because he didn't actually get a touchdown. He had 11 receptions, which is the most any receiver's gotten, I think, in the Super Bowl. 133 yards, no touchdowns. On the other side, though, Terrell Owens, I didn't realize this, had 122 yards on 9 receptions. So it was kind of funny. I mean, Brady, a somewhat pedestrian game, 22 of 33 for 236 yards, 2 touchdowns, no interceptions, though, nice. Which, again, that's the name of the game. And so went pretty well for him. He did pretty well, got the game in hand, drove the team down to put them in a position to win. And yeah, McNabb
nice.
Puked.
Nice. McNabb puked and Reed. That was he puked in a different way.
And Andy Reid was Andy Reid, and that's just indeed. The way it went.
Indeed.
All right, so what do you got for your third place, sir?
All right, so my third place, and this is where I'm going to need some help deciphering the
oh, geez. Oh, this oh, one.
40, I think it's 49.
Fredo, Coach Fredo comes back home to roost for the New England Patriot fans.
Yes.
Oh,
I don't know why I put XLIX. That doesn't seem right. Wait a minute. No, that was XLIX. Okay, so that's 49. All right, so Fredo, yeah, very nicely put.
Oh.
Patriots versus Seattle Seahawks. Patriots win 28-24. Brady is the MVP. 37 completions, 50 attempts, 328 yards, 4 TDs. I think this was the most TDs he had in a Super Bowl, unless
I believe
he
so,
outdid that
yeah.
in Tampa Bay. But he did have 2 ints. And a phenomenal rushing performance, 2 rushes for -3 yards, ladies and gentlemen. So
yeah, baby, he turned on the Jets, man. He almost was -5, but he managed to juke a guy, so he only got -3.
There we go. But I selected this one. This was another back and forth game, and obviously, the big story coming out of this was the interception at the very end. The inexplicable Pete Carroll going for a pass as opposed to handing it to the tank that was Marshawn Lynch at the time and letting him just plow through.
Oh my gosh.
Everyone this was for all intents and purposes a Seattle victory, given the time they had left and the fact they had Lynch, who was just unstoppable. But it was what it was, and they decided to throw, and the Patriots got the interception and the victory. But Brady clearly putting up, some very, very impressive stats in this game and undoubtedly the MVP for that, just given the fact that all 28 points came from passing, touchdowns. And, so overall for me, this was just a lot of these are not just about his performance, but the memories that come with the game. And, and this one was just a huge one, to just the way they won it. And the way that it just felt like it was going to be another, close loss, similar to what had happened prior with the Giants. And it was just such a surprise to see that interception happen and just for the game to go the way that it did. So, for me, this was a special game and just a special victory for one Mr. Tom Brady.
Yes. Yes, indeed. Although the reason this one didn't make the cut for me is just because really the MVP of that game should have been Pete Carroll for the New England Patriots. The game was won. Like Marshawn Lynch was money in the bank. Like that game was over. I was sitting there watching that game. I clearly remember it going, we're done here. We're done. Like not that I'm like, oh, they couldn't pull out a defensive stop or anything. But if I remember right, they had enough time for 2 plays.
Oh, yeah.
I think they had a timeout and everything. Like they could have run it into the line 2 times. I'm like that close with a game on the line, Marshawn Lynch at that point in his career, And with the Patriots defense, they were not that stout against the rush that year, if I'm remembering right.
No.
It's like, it's done. Like,
yep.
I could coach the end of this game and we're getting a win.
Yeah.
And then they threw it and I'm dumbfounded. Even as a Patriots fan, I'm like, did he just do that?
Yeah.
Like, was that bad guacamole? Did I hallucinate that? Nope, it actually happened. Like, oh my gosh. So to me, it was a good game for Brady. All of those things, yes. But oh my gosh, the main reason they won the game is because Pete Carroll was Pete Carroll.
Yeah. Yeah.
Inexplicable.
And I'm looking up real quick before we jump over to yours. I just want to pull up real quick. In that game, Marshawn Lynch, 24 rushing attempts for 102 yards, one touchdown, one reception for 31 yards. I mean, he had a impressive game, and you know, that probably would have been two touchdowns if they had just handed him the ball.
Mm-hmm. Yep. So,
yeah.
I'm pretty sure they had at least time for two plays, if not three, down by the goal line there. Unbelievable. Nice. Malcolm Butler made himself a whole lot of money off of that, because I think
yes,
he did.
And what's your number three?
So I'm going to go with the AFC divisional game against with the Patriots and the Oakland Raiders from 2001-2002. Mm-hmm. Now, depending on where you are located geographically, there are two names for this game. If you are in the New England region and you are if you're a Patriots fan anywhere in the world, it is the Snow Bowl. If you are an Oakland Raiders fan or a fan of any of the other NFL franchises and anywhere outside New England, it is the Tuck Rule game. Mm-hmm. And this one here, to me, was, I mean, you kind of got the feeling there was something special about this team all season long, just because of the way things were going. And this season really built. Like, I watched every single regular season game except for one. And that was the game against Cleveland. And I happened to be, I was traveling that day and I was driving and listening to the game on the radio, and almost drove off the road when Troy Brown ran one of his punts back right up the middle for a touchdown. Like, I was losing my mind. It was fantastic.
Yeah.
If you watched all those games and you kind of got into the rhythm of that season with this team, you realize there's something going on here that ain't nobody really can explain. Here is where it really became apparent. Because, and this is the thing where all the naysayers are like, oh yeah, baby. It's like, you don't understand. You have to really put it in context of what it was like to be a Patriots fan prior to this season, or up until this game, really. If something bad or something stupid, especially something stupid, was going to happen, it was going to happen to the Patriots, and they were going to shoot themselves in their own foot. And it was going to go wrong for them and against them and against their favor. That's just the way it was going to go.
Mm-hmm.
Just the way it was going to go. The good things did not happen to this team. Going back to, I don't know, let's go back to like the 1984 NFL draft. And the Patriots passed on Jim Kelly, John Elway, Dan Marino, and then wound up with Tony Eason.
Interesting.
And, you know, how many seasons of flopping around after that?
Yep.
And well-deserved for an idiotic move like that.
Yep.
Well-deserved. Totally deserved it. So when you hit this game and you wind up with that Tuck Rule, mm-hmm. which was interpreted correctly, mm-hmm. that and they changed the rule afterwards. You can say, oh, yeah, they had to change the rule. Yeah, but that's the rule on the books. That's the way it went. Sorry. Same as like how they talked about, they refined pass interference after the Patriots were taking advantage. Well, they were taking advantage of how the refs were calling it. That's the way it works. You wanted to not do it, change the rules, but you're not going to get on them for playing within the rules or the way that the rules are being called.
Right.
The play was interpreted correctly according to, you know, anyone who has a relative grasp of objectivity, and it benefited the Patriots. Whereas previously, the 40 years before that, it never would have happened in that way.
Mm-hmm.
And you can go back to like the Patriots game, playoff game back against the Raiders, I think in the frickin' 70s. I think it was 1976, when you had a roughing the passer call that everybody pretty much agrees was complete BS.
Mm.
Like, totally did not happen, that changed the game for the Raiders. Well, came back here. Now, the thing that people forget and that all the Raiders fans love to talk about, they act like the tuck play where Brady kept the game, like that was the winning play. It wasn't. Patriots still had to continue a drive. I think they got two more first downs in order for Vinatieri to kick the tying field goal.
Yeah.
And then they had an opportunity to stop them in overtime before they kick the winning field goal. Mm-hmm. But we leave all that out.
Yes.
So the thing about that game that for me was amazing is just watching what is essentially a rookie. He was a second year player at that time, but this is his first year starting. Brady played like a seasoned pro. There was none of the jitters, none of that. He stood in there. He delivered a ball in like wind, snow, everything else. And at that point, you knew like this could be it.
Yeah.
Like this might be the year. Like we finally got that guy who isn't going to like who isn't going to shoot us in our own foot. It was amazing. It was amazing to watch. Yeah.
No, agreed. Agreed. I remember exactly where I was when that game was on and watching it. And, you know, just when that tuck rule played out the way it did, if you want to be the superstitious Boston fan, I mean, to me, that was the point when the bad luck of the Patriots was finally getting flipped around, you know, and like you said, there was a lot of game left to play. I mean, there were field goals that could have been missed. They weren't. And you're just watching this like, oh my gosh, they're actually going to do this. And so it was a very interesting game to watch. It was, you know, like you were saying, it kind of had that tone of many, you know, prior Patriots playoff games. But yet, you know, mired in all the controversy was, you know, just that's, you know, the beginnings of what would become the norm for them, which is that rock solid, consistent play from Brady, irregardless of the conditions around him. And that was really, really interesting and fun to watch and different to watch because, quite honestly, we were just used to just seeing, you know, the fumbles and the interceptions or the bad play calling that would inevitably cause them to lose and be knocked out. And thankfully, you know, this game played out the way that it did. And you know, with Vinatieri, I mean, he's as much of
the absolute folk hero after that game,
as much of a reason for the success of the Patriots in a lot of ways as Brady was in the early going. Because
yes,
it always came down to his foot, and his foot was laser accurate. I mean, all through the 2000s, it was extraordinarily rare for him to miss something. And so, and we didn't know that up to that point. You know, this was the beginning of that becoming the norm for us, which was never, you know, normally the case. So, yeah, this is a good pick because this is the game that started a lot of the momentum that led to, you know, us seeing Brady and the Patriots really kind of go from being the little team that couldn't to the team that became the model for a lot of the rest of the league.
Yes. Yep. So what do you got for your, where are we at here? Number two.
So I don't know how you want to do this because you and I kind of went, we're inverted from each other. Same two games, but I went number two for your number one and you went number one for my number two. So
yeah, we'll just talk about both of them here because they're both excellent choices. If I do say so myself,
my number two, which is your top game, is Super Bowl 36, the one that started it all. Patriots 20, St. Louis 17, first Super Bowl championship for the Patriots. Brady, the MVP.
I still get a tingle hearing that score. I still know. Like I keep expecting someone to be like, oh, by the way, we made a scoring error. That wasn't the fun. It's really the opposite.
And, you know, again, I remember where I was when this happened. I was in, you know, my first apartment living out here in the Chicagoland area. And watching this game, I probably scared the bejesus out of my neighbors down below. Because when that field goal kick went up and went through, it was just surreal. It's like, did that really happen? Did they just literally win the game? Because this is never anything we've ever experienced before as Patriots fans. Brady's performance was somewhat pedestrian. It was 16 completions for 27 attempts, 145 yards, one touchdown. Of course, we have a rush for 3 yards. Thankfully, not negative. But But, you know, not a powerhouse performance, but a consistent and, you know, there were no interceptions, so no mistakes. But, you know, just a very, very close game, well-played game, and one in which the Patriots really, you know, kind of shone and came through and won their first Super Bowl. And not too long after that kick was through the uprights, the man they call Tim got on to the got on the horn, as Gorilla Monsoon would say, and called up Uncle Todd. And I seem to recall there was a lot of yelling and screaming going on your end as well. I think you had a little gathering of some kind going on there.
And, we did, yes.
But you know, started what would be the trend that would lead to this podcast becoming what it was, calling you up and being like, did you just say that? And us going on for, you know, several minutes about, oh, my gosh. So for me, you know, this is number two because it was the first. It has a lot of course, you know, really great memories of you know, finally our team, you know, overcoming and defeating, you know, the team that was called the greatest show on turf. I mean, they were supposed to wipe the floor with the Patriots, mm-hmm. and that did not happen. So my number two is Super Bowl 36. What about you, sir, with this game?
Well, and I concur with everything you said, the silence of the Rams game, and, you know, deservedly so. The Rams were the greatest show on turf. They were something that you just did not see come along that often. A team that was that good, that was that terrifying, mm-hmm. and it was amazing to watch that team play. They just could score at will, you know. And you can talk about, you know, Mahomes and the Chiefs now, and any number of offenses before that. And even before the Rams that year. But to me, that was one of those teams that was just so clear in my head. Like, right. Them and probably the early 90s Bills were those mm-hmm. teams that you just watched and you're like, my God, they can score from anywhere on the field, move the ball any which way they want to, and you can't stop them because they're just moving so damn fast. Mm-hmm. And that's what made them terrifying, because you're just like, even if we have the talent to go up against some of these guys, they're just going to wear you out.
Right.
They'll wear you out. And if you think that you might be able to hang with them, they're going to be better than you. Like, it was going to be not an option that you would be able to have both. You're going to be as good as them and be able to keep up with them. And so that was a terrifying game to go into. But having watched earlier in the regular season, towards the end of the regular season, when the Patriots played against the Rams in Foxborough, you kind of saw glimpses of them being able to hang with them. They lost, mm-hmm. but you kind of got a glimpse of like, well, I don't, you know, we didn't lose by that much.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
And so that, and you know, that idea of Belichick, usually if he gets a second crack at you in a season, it doesn't end well for you.
Indeed.
But Brady being a huge part of that. And again, you mentioned the pedestrian stat line, and it is extraordinarily pedestrian, considering what his stats would become towards, you know, the midpoint to the end of his career. But you got to remember, back in the day, the Patriots were very smart in the way that they brought young Mr. Brady along and kind of gave him scenarios that he would be able to be very successful in and did not ask him to do too much.
Yeah.
You know, they would ask him, they didn't really put him in a position of like, okay, you've got to carry the team all the time.
Right.
However, in this game, that final drive, they really did almost kind of be like, okay, Tom, you're the one who has to get us there.
Yeah.
We don't have anybody else Antoine Smith is not going to carry us this whole way. You know, we don't have anyone else who's going to do that. You're going to have to be the one to lead this drive. And if you remember, in leading that drive, you had John Madden saying over and over that they ought to be playing for overtime, just taking a knee and going into overtime. And it's the most I think I've ever sworn at John Madden in my life in a concentrated amount of time, because I'd been nervous drinking the entire time. So by that point, all the filters were off. And, but the idea that it's that final drive is why he was the MVP, because and not that extraordinary of a drive. It's not like Montana's 92-yard, you know, drive in the Super Bowl. It was the situation and the context going against the team, because the Rams defense was not a chump either. Like, their defense was pretty quick.
Yeah.
They could do some stuff. Like, they weren't going to hammer you, but they could play. And Brady managing to lead that drive as a second year player, a first year starter, and calmly leading that drive was a thing of beauty to watch. Because again, as a Patriots fan, you're used to the fact that, like, okay, here comes the kick to the groin.
Yep.
Here it comes.
Here comes the interception. Here comes, whatever.
Yep. And you just watched a quarterback just very calmly move the ball down the field. And of course, yes, great performances. I think it was J.R. Redman and Jerome Wiggins, making some runs after catch. But Brady just very calmly just executing and getting them down to where Vinatieri could make that kick. At that point in his career is a remarkable thing for a quarterback to be that calm in that situation against that opponent. Crazy. And if they played that game, if it was a best of seven or a best of five, Patriots do not win that series.
Right.
That was a one shot deal. That is where the one and done playoff determination worked totally in their favor. Great game. Absolutely great game. My top sporting moment of my life.
Indeed.
And I don't think it shall be replaced.
No. Because a lot of the other wins, do I remember where I was? Kind of, but it's not as burned into my brain as that one. Like that, that one I distinctly remember where I was, what the room looked like, just all the details that you don't typically remember with things, just for whatever reason is just burned in there. And especially, like I said, the phone call, and the elation. Yes, we do elate and celebrate.
Yes.
So, that was just, it's just burned into the brain as just a very, very cool memory of, them winning for the first time.
Yeah. And I remember I got several calls after that because everyone knew, and I was with a room full of people that, had all kind of shown up, I think, to either celebrate with me or it was going to be a group therapy afterwards because I was just that psycho of a fan at the time. And it was amazing. It was amazing to witness that.
Yep. Yeah.
And so my number two and your number one would be Super Bowl 51. Mm-hmm. Now, I just want to just say for any Atlanta Falcons fans out there right now, trigger warning, because we are going to set the context here of ATL 28 NE3. Mm-hmm. And if you know what that means, you know what comes next, because the final score ended up being Patriots 34, Falcons 28.
Yes.
This is the first Super Bowl in history to go into overtime. And Atlanta was leading 28-3 midway through the third quarter. It didn't end that way. Brady, Super Bowl MVP, a virtuoso performance.
Yep. Yep. And the Atlanta defense was just, I think they didn't pace themselves the right way because they just seemed just dead at the end of the game. But they were extremely energetic in the first half. You know what I mean? They were hitting them hard. There was a lot of celebrating going on when they would just make tackles and stop Brady and that sort of thing. And I really think in some ways there wasn't enough gas in the tank to get all the way through. And the Patriots just started coming back, Brady, leading them. Now, not all those 34 points were him. There was a lot of rushing going on in that game, but his stats were very impressive, very close to the Super Bowl 52 performance, where he went 43 of 62, 466 yards, two TDs. He did have one interception, and he did have a rush for 15 yards. So,
ooh, that's right.
So the gazelle was in full display. So, but went into overtime and basically it was that rushing touchdown which put him over the edge, and won them that game. I made this my number one because, while the first Super Bowl was clearly a very, was a milestone memory, very, very much burned into my brain, like I talked about, this one to me was just like a such a surprise. And I mean, it was just, the first half was just so depressing. And you're just like, what is going on with this team? What happened to them? Why does this have to always happen to us, sort of thing? It was just a sort of, oh, woe is me. And then yeah, when you get to that 212 mark in the third quarter and they start marching down the field and Brady's, you know, they're starting to connect and score and make things happen on offense. And you're just like, what the heck is going on? And you get into the fourth quarter and they keep doing it and they're scoring and they're getting closer and like, oh my gosh, they might pull this off. They tie it up, goes into OT. And now you're just on like, you know, you're standing on the edge of the couch, like, you know, just,
oh so yeah,
nobody move, you know,
yeah, everybody's in their lucky spot. Nobody's getting up to pee. Like this we have gone to the mattresses.
Oh my God. And I
like to refer to this game as today I have settled all family business for Tom Brady. Like, amen. If there was any doubt,
amen,
about, you know, who he was as a player and what his legacy would be, this is it right here. Because, mm-hmm, I mean, you don't, as a system quarterback, you don't come back 28-3 in the Super Bowl with a quarter and a half left.
Cool.
That
hand
just don't
Tom.
Happen. Yeah. Now, arguably, you know, you have the stat line here. You know, which is amazing to look at. Arguably, Brady should not have been the Super Bowl MVP. Mm. James White, mm-hmm, makes an excellent case as Super Bowl MVP. He was 6 carries for 29 rushing yards, which is not that impressive. LeGarrette Blount, was 11 for 31. Yeah, I just, never mind. We'll talk about LeGarrette some other time. But had 2 rushing touchdowns and a 2-point conversion, but it was really 14 receptions and 110 yards through the air, plus a receiving touchdown. He apparently, I think he had three total touchdowns, mm-hmm, in this game, and was really kind of the spark plug and was the workhorse of the New England offense. Julian Edelman, of course, was amazing as well, even though he was definitely concussed. Another one of those things that the NFL doesn't like to talk about, but there was definitely a blank spot in his memory from this game. And, but yeah, just, man, such a great game to watch, such a great game. And was one of those things where it just full on full display, like the fact that just would not quit, which is pretty much the story of Tom Brady's career. Like, just would not quit until it ain't done until Tom says it's done. And that's kind of the way he went out, even in retirement, was, I'm not done until I say I am.
Yep.
And damn. Yep. But yes, an excellent choice.
Kind of going back to Rocky II with Duke, just like, he just kept coming.
Yeah.
We don't need that trouble in our life, baby.
Yeah. I mean, it's crazy. Absolutely crazy.
It is.
So now we have to talk about legacy and just a little bit, because we're already running kind of late in this episode. But when has that ever stopped us?
No, of course.
So do you feel that Tom Brady, and this is kind of an unusual thing because this isn't as kind of straightforward as it used to be, but it's still worth asking. Does going to another team at the end of his career diminish his legacy at all to you?
I don't really think so. I think there's 2 ways to look at it. As a pure Patriots fan, you know, do I feel it diminished anything? You know, maybe it tarnishes it a little bit, because you would have liked to have seen him end with the Patriots, end on a high note, you know, have that 7th Super Bowl with them and kind of ride off into the sunset. However, And you have to qualify this with Brady, because this isn't anything Manning did or, and this isn't a slam on them, but it's a fact. You know, Brady throughout his career, made a lot of sacrifices from a contractual standpoint, money-wise,
yep,
to allow the Patriots to build the team around him, and, you know, and to build the defense as well, to be contenders consistently. And, you know, I don't want to sit here, because I mean, he's made millions of dollars and, you know, will continue to do so. So he's not hurting for money. And this isn't meant to complain in any way, shape or form on his behalf, but
and Giselle has had quite a little nest egg of her own before they got together.
he made these choices for very unselfish and for team related reasons. And those decisions paid off for him in the long run, because it led to him building a legacy with the Patriots that he could then take to another team where he could earn the kind of money that he didn't typically earn. And he could be recognized, you know, monetarily for the quarterback that he is, which is, you know, in fact, you know, he is the greatest of all times, you know, statistically and championship wise. And so it doesn't bother me as much. You know, you said at the beginning of the segment, it's just, we saw the Patriots win more championships than they probably deserve to, or we ever thought we would see. And how can I get upset about that? You know what I mean? Like, it's just, it's not really for me as a fan to get upset. We have, as we just talked through, a lot of really amazing memories of not just our team winning, but our team winning in a dramatic way. And it just being a very, just a fulfilling kind of ride to have a player of that caliber and of that consistency be with your organization for as long as he did and win as many titles as he did. And so I don't think it diminishes it. I think if anything, it enhances it. It shows he went to another team. Obviously they had pulled in the right talent around him, you know, similar to what happened with the Patriots, but he went there. It wasn't a foregone conclusion they were going to win, and they went on their run, and they, you know, they won last year, and now he has, you know, under his cap, not only just winning with Belichick, but winning with another head coach. So I think if anything, it increases his legacy. It maybe rounds it out really well, because he was able to do this under two different coaches, under two different coaching staffs and organizations. And it just goes to continue, you know, that the idea that he is this very consistent, very high level, high caliber kind of player who works very hard, brings it on the field. And, you know, the game is never in doubt, or it's never a foregone conclusion. You've won the game, as Atlanta will tell you, when you're facing Tom Brady. And so, I think he made the choice for him, you know, made the right choice for him, as much as Boston fans may not like it. But I don't think it diminishes it at all. I think it enhances it, and it cements it.
I would agree wholeheartedly. I really can't elaborate on it any better than you can. So I will agree. And yes, it's disappointing, but not diminishing.
Yes. Yep.
So next question, in terms of legacy, does going out on a playoff defeat diminish his legacy at all, do you think?
No, I don't. I think the whole idea of, you know, going and winning the Super Bowl and then retiring afterwards is, of course, the storybook ending. And, you know, you have some who have been able to pull that off. The timing worked out. He certainly could have done it last year, you know, when they won, and, you know, decided to make another run for it. I don't think it does. I think the stats, the memories, the play, have all cemented the kind of player he is, and just the consistency and high caliber nature of what he does has never been in question across these seasons. You know, it just wasn't their time this year. And you know, that is to be expected. I don't, and I'm not just saying this for Brady. I think for any player, I think he is so different in that it is never a foregone conclusion that you're going to go back to the Super Bowl after you've been there. And a lot of players, a lot of teams, and especially in the AFC, have had to suffer that because the Patriots had gone so many times. And so, you know, it's one of those things that if you can make it to the big dance and you can win it, savor it. But, you know, unless the you know, everything is aligned for the timing to work out, it's just not something you can plan for. And I don't think it diminishes his legacy in the least, because he's got the 7 under his belt. He's got the MVPs. He's got the stats. He's got all the plays and the memories. And I just think that all of those things, you know, just stand on their own. And so, He goes out the way, you know, a lot of guys go out, which is you don't make it to the big game, or you lose it, and it's just time to hang it up. So what about you?
I don't think so, because it's such a rare thing. I mean, first of all, there's only one team that ends their season with a win. That's just the nature of the way things work. Like, there's only one team that does not lose the last game of the season.
Yep.
And so you have to put it in those parameters. And there's only two quarterbacks who have ever managed to have that storybook ending. Mm-hmm. And that would be John Elway and Peyton Manning.
Yep.
And arguably, you know, John Elway went out winning his last two Super Bowls, even though, I mean, Terrell Davis, good Lord, that's one of the main reasons why Elway was able to finish out his career that way, because Terrell Davis was a freaking monster in the NFL at that, for, you know, for the brief period of time that he was at his apex, was just unstoppable.
Yep.
It was crazy watching him. Yeah. It was kind of the precursor to like LaDainian Tomlinson, but in a totally different way. Like Terrell Davis just knocked people over. Mm-hmm. LaDainian Tomlinson just beat you every which way you could possibly imagine. It was terrifying in his own way. But you know, Elway arguably kind of went out winning the Super Bowls. Peyton Manning was really along for the ride, you know?
Yeah.
And that's not to try and diminish Peyton Manning. Cause I mean, there's already, you can look at the stats and look at that and you can judge it on your own. Manning did not do a whole lot except, you know, just hand the ball off, throw the couple of passes that he needed to, and that was about it. That was not a Peyton Manning win. That was a Denver Broncos win. But, hey, it worked out, and he was cooked at that point. He was on fumes. Yeah. And, hey, it's great that he managed to do it. So I don't think so at all. It would have been nice for him, of course. And I think that the reason he came back is because he legit thought he had another chance to win. I really do. I think if he had won the Super Bowl this year, it would have been the same result. I think he would have retired.
Yeah.
But just didn't work out that way. So yeah. I don't think so at all. My next question, though, is here is probably the most foolish question out of all of these. Is there any argument about who is the NFL GOAT? Any?
No, and there shall be no adjudication. There shall be no debation or any sort of argumentation on this. He is for all intents and purposes and forever shall be the GOAT until such time as someone. Well, I guess that would break the whole forever and all time. But you know, if someone can somehow win that 8th Super Bowl or post the kind of stats he did. I just don't see it happening. We got to witness and we got to have on our team a very unique player in the same mold as Jordan, in the same mold as you know, Gretzky and a lot of others who have transcended, you know, their sport in terms of their skill and their ability to, you know, work through pressure situations. And I just don't see it. You know, I mean, it's going to be a very long time until we see someone who can do that again at the level that he did for as long as he did, and it's not the norm. So I feel very confident in saying no.
And I would agree. There is no argument. He is the GOAT. There are 7 Lombardi trophies with his name on them.
Mm-hmm.
I and the fact that you talked about winning an 8th, I mean, good God. You know, when we talked about, you know, the greats,
yep.
You talk about Montana winning, what, he won 4, correct?
Yeah.
He won four Super Bowls. Terry Bradshaw won 4 Super Bowls. And those were like dynasties. Those were like, oh my gosh. And you talked about those franchises in, not just those teams, but those franchises in hushed tones.
Mm-hmm.
This is a dude who won 7 Super Bowls, 6 of them with one team.
Yep.
I thinking about someone trying to win 8 is absurd to me, because you have to get to 8.
I mean, that's
just
what I was
in the first place.
I would love to see how many players, both active or even in the recent past, have been to 10 Super Bowls.
None. Like
he has a 7-3 record. He has been to 10. He's lost 3. He's won 7.
Yeah, and there's people who want to talk about those 3 that he lost. I'm like, oh yeah, okay, right.
Yeah.
That's cute. Yeah. That's cute. Yeah. That's cute. So let me see. Philly fans. Yeah, okay, so you got your 1.
Yeah.
That's awesome. Good on you. But Tom Brady lost as many Super Bowls as your team has played in history.
Yep.
You know, again, like, I've always said it, like, all the people who are Patriots haters, they would have loved to have had a 5-year, 6-year span of what he did with the Patriots. They would have loved to have had just a third of his career,
yeah,
for their team.
Mm-hmm.
They would have loved it to have their team be in competition for the championship every single year, be winning the division every year, to be in the conversation of winning that championship and perhaps winning a championship or two. they would have, Lions fans would have sold their grandmother's right arm and leg along with whatever possessions they could cobble together to have 2 years of Brady's career.
Yep.
I mean, if you think about it, if you take the first 2 years of Tom Brady's career as a starter and you gave that to the Lions, Lions fans would be talking about that for the rest of the time.
Yeah.
A Super Bowl and like two seasons where the team just doesn't suck, that they're above 500, that through the roof.
Yep.
I mean, gosh, I mean, just the fact, I mean, if you told Cleveland Browns fans that they could have a span of time where they'd have one quarterback starting for their team and not having this like quarterback roulette that's been going on since they've come back to the NFL, they'd be tickled pink. Forget about any freaking championships.
Yep.
Just the fact that they wouldn't have to deal with like the Kelly Holcombs of the world.
Right.
And the Tim Couches of the world, they would have been ecstatic. It's crazy.
It is.
The next question, and this kind of leads into what we had talked about with someone getting to those Super Bowls. Will anyone else get anywhere close anytime soon?
I already kind of mentioned this on the last question, but you know, I don't think so. I mean, I think you can look at someone like Patrick Mahomes. Does he have a shot? Maybe. But that all depends on if the organization continues to build a solid team around him. And that's the one thing that I've not seen any other franchise do very consistently, other than the Patriots, which is to somehow put together teams that are competitive and can be, you know, making a case for the playoffs consistently.
Yeah.
But doing so without, you know, getting all superstars, you know, I mean, all these teams that came together. Yeah. There were some high performers in there, no doubt, but Belichick was building teams that were very much, you know, players who were, you know, just not highly valued or thought to be, you know, kind of on the tail end of their career. And yet they get to the Patriots and they have this, like this renaissance or reinvigoration being on the team. So I just think that, you know, some of what led to Brady's status being what it is also the organization that was around him as well. And, you know, Tampa Bay clearly made the right moves and put the right pieces in place for him as well. So, and I just think that's rare. And I just don't know that there's going to be, you know, a player or a franchise that's going to have the longevity of doing that.
Yes. And that is the key. It's not necessarily down to the player. Because like we said, I mean, Patrick Mahomes plays 16 years and averages 38 touchdowns a year. He ties Brady.
Yep.
And you got to figure if you're doing that well, you're going to have some opportunities. You know, in a statistical sense, you're going to have some opportunities at some championship teams throwing that many touchdowns. You're going to win a lot of games.
Yeah. Yeah.
However, it's finding a period of time. And even then, I mean, if you'd have to say that he'd have to go to a Super Bowl like every other year. And I mean, he's been to two now. Okay. He won one, but okay. Seven more to go.
Right. Right.
You know, I mean, so you figure just in order to do that, like you said, you got to have the right owner. You got to have the right coach. Now I'd say you might be able to make do with, you know, multiple coaches. It might work. Yeah. Although, you know, we saw that with Indianapolis, you know, you had Tony Dungy there for a long time. Then you start getting into, you know, the Jim Caldwells and, you know, it doesn't quite work out as well, but, you know, it was still successful.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
The right ownership is the key. Just go ask a Dallas Cowboys fan.
Yep.
How much ownership means.
Yeah.
When you've had the talent that team has had over the past 20, 30 years, ever since Jimmy Johnson left. But you're saddled with an owner who still thinks that he is a hotshot GM when he clearly ain't, right, and who won't shut up. Yep. Ask them. Ask, again, not to pick on the Lions fans, but I mean, it's right there. Go ask Lions fans how much ownership means. And the way that the Fords have run that team for into the ground for decades now, ever since like the 1950s, I think was the last time that the Lions were actually any kind of success, you know, any kind of threat to become a championship team. So it's you have to find that. And that's why kind of the Mahomes to me is the interesting one, because the Chiefs have been a fairly stable franchise for an awfully long time.
Yeah.
And I think that he is probably, if he can stay healthy, which is always a threat with a dude who runs, you know, I mean, it's a threat for anyone. I mean, look at Brady. Brady don't run and he still got taken out for one season. But still, if you're running around out in the open field and you don't have the protections of, you know, the passer in the pocket, starts getting dicey about how long you're actually going to physically be able to play.
Right.
Now, hopefully he can do it, but he's already had one gruesome injury, you know, that kind of really messed him up. I don't know.
Yeah.
But I mean, it's having that ownership, being able to take care of a player and a team and put the right people in place over that long a period of time that is the key. And man, there's just damn few that can do it, that are going to be able to do it. So therefore we bring Bradygeddon to a close.
Yes.
Finally, maybe. I mean, who's to say that come September, all of a sudden we won't hear, nah, I'm just kidding, I'm back.
I was going to say, maybe we bring this out one more time for the Hall of Fame edition or something.
Yeah. All it's going to take is like Tampa's quarterback to go down next year about October, November for whispers to come out like, you know, Tom's still in really good shape. He's still eating a lot of tofu. he's still very pliable, very pliable.
Oh, dear.
And if that happens, you know what? We're just going to all ignore it. We won't do another Brady. Oh, who are we kidding? We're going to do another Bradygeddon. But this is the finalist chapter of Bradygeddon. Thank you for the memories, Tom. Thank you for the six championships, and to all the New England fans who absolutely freaked out when New England didn't get readily mentioned right up front in his like Instagram announcement or whatever. Just again, go over in the corner with the Star Wars fans. Soak your head for an hour or so.
Probably
just
the same
calm
ones that are
down.
Complaining about Book of Boba Fett too.
Yes, it probably the Venn diagram is basically an overlap circle.
Yeah,
it's just a single circle.
Exactly.
It's
exactly.
The same people.
Yeah.
And another thing.
So what have you got for And Another Thing this week, sir?
So my And Another Thing is a little different from past ones. Not a show, not a book, but more an exercise program. I've been starting this up over the last few weeks because, quite frankly, I need to be doing something, you know, to stay, you know, somewhat in shape, especially during this cold and frigid winter where sleet, snow, rain, and apparently whatever's falling over in Maine is kind of the order of the day.
So you're not putting on like the Rocky, like gray sweats with the towel stuck in the collar.
Not quite.
Going out, do your road work.
No.
Oh, that's so disappointing.
I would never be able to warm up given the extreme cold we're experiencing here in the Chicagoland area. But yeah, so, several years back, I kind of got turned on to this, through wrestling, but Diamond Dallas Page, who is a long since retired wrestler, WWE Hall of Famer, created a yoga slash kind of exercise program called DDP yoga. And, I started doing this, as a way to kind of lose some weight prior to some of the dietary things I've been doing. And I just decided to get back into it to just, cause not only is it good for the exercise part, but there's also, you know, just because it's yoga, it helps, you know, with your flexibility, pliability, and, you know, strength and that sort of thing. And so, so I've been doing that, over the last, 2-3 weeks, just trying to kind of, get myself into a little bit of a pattern, you know, to get some exercise and to kind of build up, some of the micro strength that I am lacking when it comes to things like doing planks and some what you would think to be simple exercises where, you know, I'll go into the plank or the starting push-up position and all of a sudden start trembling like crazy because I'm like, oh, there are those micro muscles that have no strength in them right now. So,
yep.
So just trying to, you know, build up, but just, you know, overall, just find something for yourself that you can do during this wonderful time of year we call January and February winter. And, you know, check it out if you haven't. It's a nice combination of yoga with some dynamic resistance style training. It's not hard on the joints, not hard on the body. It's just about engaging muscles and really just kind of doing your own resistance as you're doing exercises to kind of engage and you know, kick your heart rate up. And so I would highly recommend it. It's been a lot of fun, and DDP works you hard. So do check it out, DDP Yoga.
Isn't it crazy how when you're doing like a plank, and for the first 10, 15 seconds, you're like, oh, I got this. It's cake. Yep. And then it all hits you at once, like, oh, ah.
I know.
All those muscles like, we're good. No, we're not.
It's crazy. Yeah. And what's kind of, what I found kind of interesting about it is that, is just all these like little areas where, you think you have strength and you begin to realize, well, you have strength for about 5 seconds and then everything starts to just fall apart. And you know, this was something he developed not only for himself, but there's been several wrestlers like AJ Styles, Chris Jericho. I'm trying to think of a couple others, maybe Edge, where they had back issues. And when they went and did this, it actually, it's one of the reasons Jericho can still wrestle right now is because he went through and did it and actually rehabilitated his back, which, you know, after 20 plus years of wrestling is probably not in great shape. Oh, Shawn Michaels is another one. So a lot of wrestlers have actually adopted this because it has done a lot for just the wear and tear they've kind of gone through in the ring and has helped kind of rejuvenate their backs and just their pliability as well, through doing this. So yeah, check it out if you're interested.
Very nice. Very nice. Repping DDP.
Indeed. How about you, sir?
Well, so I had a kind of an odd night last night where we watched The Wizard of Oz as a family for the first time ever, which was a total parent fail that our daughter is now 14 and has not ever seen The Wizard of Oz. We realized we need to remedy that situation.
Yes.
And it probably not the greatest thing to throw at a teenager because she was sort of like, meh. I was like, yeah, okay, fine. I get it. Like if you were 6 or 7 watching this, it probably would have been a better time.
Yeah.
But oh well, we at least checked it off the list. Nice. So then everyone else goes to bed and I'm left to my own devices, and I didn't really know what I wanted to watch. And I ended up watching this movie for probably the second or third time. And I don't know why, but it's a movie to me that is a bit of comfort food for some reason. Probably just because I'm a weirdo. But the movie in question is called American Splendor. And it is the story of Harvey Pekar, who is an underground comic writer, not an illustrator, but it was a comic by the same name, American Splendor. From the streets of Cleveland comes American Splendor. And a very interesting cat. He worked as a file clerk at the VA in Cleveland and was very into music, comics. And he started writing his own comic that was basically autobiographical, his own life, everyday sort of like middle class, lower middle class life. And then different comic artists would illustrate it. And so the different issues would look different. Like he would be represented differently in all these issues because it would be different illustrators working on it.
Oh, interesting.
And it is a Paul Giamatti movie. So Paul Giamatti, of course, is playing Harvey Pekar, but it's narrated by the real Harvey Pekar. And there's a couple segments where they'll show him. And there's one segment in particular that is great. They finish this close up on like a bag of jelly beans. And then they kind of cut to this white space, like it's just an all white room. And that's where they kind of have Harvey Pekar doing his narration, and they show him a couple of different times. And they finish this close up with Paul Giamatti, and he goes over and he walks over to these chairs. And there's another actor who's playing this other guy, Toby, and they go and they sit on these like director's chairs over on the kind of the back corner of the screen of the frame. And in the front of the frame is the real Toby and the real Harvey Pekar. And they're talking. And you can kind of tell that it's somewhat scripted, but not really 100% scripted. And you just see Paul Giamatti in the back just cracking up, watching these, like the character, the guy he's playing and this other person and just interacting. And you can just see him just with this smile on his face, like, oh my gosh, this is my job. Really?
That's funny.
And, so it's kind of it's a good movie. It's not like a triumphant sort of thing or whatever, but there's a lot of wry humor, a lot of just goofy. If you're into weird kind of movies like me, it's good fun to watch, and I highly recommend it. Like I said, second or third time I've watched it, and it's just the right thing of when you're not looking for something that's like too like saccharine-y sweet. Mm-hmm. But you kind of want a little realism, but you don't want like realism, like, and then it's a downer at the end where you're like, oh, life is horrible.
Yeah.
Nothing, everything is meaningless. To me, this is, it was just about right. But then again, if you're not into weird movies, don't know if you're going to dig it. So
nice.
But American Splendor, give it a try. I just almost broke my knuckle on my desk.
Ow.
You okay over
Gosh.
There? Jeez.
Patrick, I think I'm good. Patrick, can you get an ice pack?
Oh, boy.
No, no, it's in the freezer. That, just give me some ice that I keep in there for the bourbon.
You throwing up, you the referee,
the ice?
For an injury there or something?
What'd you use all the ice for? You were trying to make your own ice cream. Using ice, milk, and yogurt? You're making... How have you lived this long? Never mind, don't answer.
Anyways, sorry. So American Splendor, don't break your knuckle. And anyways, folks, thank you very much for listening. We now must bid adieu to all the members of the Free Range Idiocy congregation. Parting is such sweet sorrow, unless, of course, like I've said before, you're trapped in a car with somebody who's been forcing you to listen to this, in which case you are very thankful that this is coming to an end. But thank you for tuning in, for subscribing. We do certainly appreciate all of you listeners out there, all the members of the congregation tuning in and being with us, reading from the holy scriptures of idiocy. If you have not subscribed, well, what the hell is wrong with you? Go to freerangeidiocy.com. You can find all of our episodes there and subscribe through Podbean. If you'd like, you can find us on Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, iHeartRadio, many others. Go ahead and search for us. Ask for us by name, if you will. If you'd like to up your game into the Free Range Idiocy congregation, perhaps to a minor deacon level, you can go ahead and like us on the social medias. Follow us even. We're on the Facebook. We're on the Twitter. We're on the Instagram. All of those are at Free Range Idiocy. If you have any questions, thoughts, complaints, any suggestions for shows, especially if you have complaints, though, send those to Tim at freerangeidiocy.com, and he will get back to you shortly. I guess. I don't know. He might just throw him out, but I doubt it because, again, he is the caring human being and I'm just the curmudgeon. So that's the way it goes. See, right there, you have a guarantee from the man they call Tim.
Indeed.
He is much like Santa Claus. He reads all of your letters, even if you've been bad. Well, especially if you've been bad, because those are the fun ones. Anyways, now it's time for me to stop talking and to hand this over to the man they call Tim, but not before I ask the second most important question ever asked in the history of humankind. The first, of course, being what is hip. The second of all being, what the hell did we learn this episode?
We've learned the following, my friend.
Good.
We have learned that high recommendation for Aaron Douglas. If you were in the market for a cameo, he is fantastic. And once again, I want to thank him for what he put forth for Uncle Todd on his birthday.
Thank you, Chief.
Do check that out. And like I said, do highly recommend it. We have learned Uncle Todd, he was able to go 5 for 5 in the Red 5 trivia. So well done, sir.
And yeah, thanks.
Look forward to more stellar performances in the weeks to come. As we talked,
somebody's looking forward to it.
As we talked about, Book of Boba Fett Chapter 7 is going to be an amazing payoff, I believe, to a very slow building, slow simmering story that has been just fun to take in and watch. And I'm excited to see what other surprises they have in store for us, potential other characters they could bring in to just kind of round this thing out and make it a solid finale to this series. But do check that out. And then finally, not that we have learned as much as we have reflected on and appreciated the career and legacy of Tom Brady, and especially for these two knuckleheads here on this podcast, and how a lot of those Super Bowl victories and matchups were, you know, led to the multi-hour phone calls afterwards, which then begat this fine podcast. So it's been fun to kind
of... So if you are one of those people who hates this podcast, just blame Tom Brady.
One more reason,
it's
right?
All his fault. It's all his fault. The Tuck rule, your team getting their tails kicked in every year. It's all Tom Brady. And you know what?
That isn't going the way you want it to.
Yeah, that's Tom Brady too. That's Tom Brady too. He's being consulted on every script. It's all Tom Brady.
Indeed.
And you know what? I'm sorry, but I can't hear you over my Super Bowl rings.
Indeed. So we again close the door for we believe to be the final time on this sort of discussion on his career, on his legacy, and we look forward to seeing where the NFL goes next and who are going to be the ones that follow in the wake of such an amazing career. With all that being said, as we like to close things, be safe, be healthy, be kind, be good to one another. And, you know, it's got to save some shekels for Valentine's Day, so please, hit the lights on the way out.
What the hell was that?
It's like I took the wrong week to quit drinking.
I beg your pardon, what did you say?
Struck a nerve, have I? Which I find rather impossible to believe. You think this is over? This is not over! You have not had the last! No more Mr. Nice Guys!
You are such a disappointing pair. I prayed so hard for you. Get out. And don't come back until you've redeemed yourselves.
So say we all.
So say we all.
Wait a minute. Who put you in charge?
Well, that's a good question. The answer is no one. But this is a government ship, and I am the senior government official, so that puts me in charge.
I swear, Patriots took 5 years off my life. Patrick trying to make it 10.
Now get the hell out of here!